celebrating 10 years of excellence.
It's a place dripping with history, and Fox Sports puts you there. Darlington Raceway, where drivers earn their stripes. Four races this year, only two winners. These guys, Matt Kenseth and Dale Earnhardt Jr., saying, catch us if you can. Today, maybe Kasey Kahne can. The 23-year-old rookie is hot on the pole and hot on their heels. Watch the drama unfold on a track the young drivers call old school. Throwback racing is next on Fox. Today, this is where America gathers every weekend for racing. The Dodge Free Race Show. You can take life as it comes. You can grab life by the horns.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, would you please rise for our invocation to be presented by Harold King of the Darlington Raceway.
Let us pray. God of grace, God of mercy, we beseech this hour to bless this NASCAR event and these great NASCAR fans. May your protective shield surround the drivers and give peace to those that support them. We continue to pray for President Bush that you may give him a clarity of mind in all of his decision making. A special blessing we ask for those in the armed forces of our great nation as they cover this world to protect the freedoms of all mankind. We offer this prayer in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, to honor America, our national anthem presented by New Song.
Of our national anthem as the crews, the drivers getting ready to get in their cars. Seven drivers tackling this track for the first time. The walls are closing in. Mike Joy and Larry McReynolds join Darrell to call the race in a moment.
Welcome back to Darlington Raceway, which today hosts its 100th NASCAR Cup race. A man who knows this place well and has been to Victory Lane here in five of those 100 races shows us today's DW's hotspot.
Okay, I'll tell them. Folks, I just had a conversation with the lady in the black. She is ticked off. They have taken these notorious walls and covering them up with, oh my, I hate to even say it, safer barriers. Look at this foam. Look at this new steel wall here. They have made Darlington safer. And the lady in black is not happy. I asked her, I said, so where are the hot spots? She said, you got to find them. Racing into turn one, side by side, the lady in black said, that's a no-no. Or here, coming out of turn two. Now, personally, I think this is going to be where she's going to put up her biggest fight because she's still got some of those old walls left. It could be here in the middle of three and four. She can even get you coming in the pits. Oh, by the way, and of course there's always an oh, by the way. You see all those pretty race cars in there? After the race, that's going to be the Lady in Black's junkyard.
Thanks, TW. The first driver to head off into the corner and perhaps test those hot spots will be Casey Kane. He is our Bud Pole winner for the second time this season. Budweiser, official beer of NASCAR, is the proud sponsor of the Bud Pole Award. Since 1979, Anheuser-Busch has awarded more than $8 million as title sponsor of NASCAR's Pole Award program. Five races, three Bud Pole winners so far. Our starting grid will crawl across the screen so you can find your favorite driver. As the grandstands have filled, pit road and the grid are ready. And we're just about to get the Carolina Dodge Dealers 400 underway. It is a beautiful, cloudless day here in Darlington, a great day to go racing. Let's go trackside to get things started.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, with the most exciting words in the world of motorsports, members of the Carolina Dodge Dealers Association.
Gentlemen, start your engines!
Drivers and their teams are at the ready. So is NASCAR on Fox. And NASCAR's most historic racetrack, Mike Choi with Larry McReynolds and three-time Winston Cup champ, Darrell Waldrop. Have you ever?
Don't go there.
Well, have you ever seen two races that were, let's say, not quite as exciting as the two we've had the last 2 weeks, and how is today going to be different?
Well, today could be very different based on track conditions, weather. We had rain last night. The thing about today, Mike, is the team that makes the least amount of mistakes. Everybody's going to make a mistake, whether it's coming in the pits, brushing the wall. The guy that makes the least amount of mistakes today could end up in victory circle.
Larry, who would you want in the seat today? One of those crafty old veterans like DW here, or one of those young kids full of enthusiasm and energy?
Well, I'm torn between Jeff and Darrell on that one. Yeah, I think I want one of those young veterans. They don't know anything about how these walls were before the safer barriers. And you know what? They're on the gas from the minute they drop the screen flag. But I think at the end of the day, I want someone that knows you have to race this racetrack. And you know what? I want one of those veteran crew chiefs in those pits as well that knows when to put those four tires on, especially under a green flag stop. And this racetrack is known to settle down and get those long green runs.
And just for the record, we never
have.
Singer Wireless and Fox Sports team up to bring NASCAR fans a chance to win a VIP trip for two to the 400 at Daytona this July. The winner becomes the virtual crew chief of Team Singular, gets a chance to meet Robbie Gordon and Richard Childress, and take the Richard Petty driving experience. Stay tuned for the Singular virtual crew chief questions in today's race on your Singular Wireless phones or go to foxsports.com.
Like sand through an hourglass.
Big wheel keep on turning. Proud Mary keep on turning. Rolling, rolling, rolling.
So are the races of our season. Previously seen on As the Wheel Turns.
Darlington, it's a big soap opera here.
I'm just a rookie.
Oh, the Lady in Black.
1 year ago today, we made history.
Last year, Fischler came in second. But really, what's 2/1000ths of a second amongst friends?
Oh my God, what's next?
Have you ever?
I have.
No, I've never.
Yes, I have.
Thank you very much.
We made you wait.
But today's the day I want to earn my real stripes. At the track, it's too tough to tame.
We made you wonder.
See if I can conquer her instead of her conquering me.
The television novel that tells the story of As the Wheel Turns.
Proud Mary, keep on turning, burning.
That's not burning.
What I love about this soap opera is you couldn't script it.
Yeah, and don't ever talk about my singing.
All right, we're getting ready to race at Darlington. Let's go to Speedway Illustrated's Dick Bergren.
Well, last year here at Darlington, Ricky Craven dazzled the racing world when he won in one of the closest finishes in NASCAR history. He's got the same car today that he won with last year. Says it's his favorite car. That's no surprise. Calls Darlington his favorite racetrack. That's no surprise. Here's the surprise. Last year he won after starting way back in 31st spot. Today he starts even further back in 36th. But I talked to him this morning. He said he's got the car dialed in since qualifying. And if he can just get through all that traffic, we may see another fantastic Darlington finish starring Ricky Craven. To Steve Burns.
Hey, Dick, it's been 64 races between visits to victory lane for 45-year-old veteran Mark Martin, a guy who's won 33 times. But yesterday at happy hour practice, he ran more laps than anybody else, and more importantly, he posted the fastest lap of any other driver. His crew chief, Pat Trison, says he's been racing mad inside that race car, and that's a good sign. It means he wants to get back to victory lane. Matt Yoakum, Steve.
Jeff Gordon has 6 wins here at Darlington, but Jeff last year failed to finish in the top 10 for the first time at this racetrack since his rookie year back in 1993. His car extremely tight in the final practice session. Crew chief Robbie Loomis told me the car just would not react. They made a number of changes, but it'll take the lap 25 today to see if those changes have helped the race car, because the Busch race and the weather has changed this racetrack. Mike?
Thanks, Matt. Bottom of the screen, you see our starting grid and crew chiefs included as that goes by, as they pass the David Pearson Tower in turn 4 for this track's all-time winner. Here's our NASCAR on Fox weather update.
There you see the air temperature, 70 degrees, and look at here, turns 1 and 2 is different temperature from 3 and 4. Those ends are different as well. This racetrack is shaped like an egg. Both ends, one end's narrow, one end's wider, but I think the biggest challenge on these crew chiefs is we got a, what do you call it, toad strangler last night for rain. It washed all the rubber off, so I look for these cars to be very loose, not grip the racetrack till some rubber gets laid back down on the track.
She's a hard-boiled egg, too.
Today, they'll run 293 laps to complete 400 miles.
There you see the pit went as far as fuel, 70 to 80 laps, but the real key is 50 to 60 laps on tires. This racetrack is like a piece of 80 grit sandpaper. Those drivers will want fresh tires after about 15 laps, though.
We saw Joe Nemechek fall victim to that yesterday in the Diamond Hill Plywood 200, the Busch Series race, where he came in for his second set of tires before the rest of the field and then found himself wanting when another caution came out and he couldn't get fresh rubber. No restriction on how many tires you can bolt on today. There will be lots of them, as there will be lots of NASCAR on Fox onboard cameras. Mark Martin, Dale Jr., Casey Kane, Michael Waltrip, Jeremy Mayfield, Ricky Rudd, Robbie Gordon, and Derek Cope.
Well, DW, it's a short track with super speedway characteristics. 170 miles an hour off into turn 1. Reach a pair and pull those belts tight, please.
Ladies and gentlemen, get ready. They're coming to the green. Get on your feet.
Boogity, boogity, boogity. Let's go racing, men. Good clean start. Everybody wants to find that groove heading off into turn 1. Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the 8 car, he falls back in third. That's about all he could do starting on the outside of the front row. He had to yield to Greg Biffle in the 16 car that started third.
And you know what, Mike? They run one turn, they're on the car and complain about their car.
I'm loose! I'm really loose!
Casey Kane, what a rookie phenom he has been these first few races as he leads Greg Biffle for lap 1.
Tell you, a lot of fingers pointed at that 16 car, though, this morning in the garage here. Greg Biffle, he won the Busch race here yesterday, said he did have one of the best cars on long runs in happy hour practice yesterday.
And he had a great car here last year. Could have won this race, and the car was bottoming out, and he broke his flywheel, eventually put him out of the race.
On the start, casual contact between Scott Riggs and Ricky Rudd, no damage.
So the battle for eighth right here, Rusty Wallace in the 2 car, Jeff Gordon in the 24 car. Right now, we kind of have two grooves of racing with these cars on those fresh tires, but that will go away.
So, Darrell, how important is it to pass them when you can in the first couple laps?
Boy, I tell you what, just watching Rusty and Jeff in the Rusty in the 2 and Jeff in the 24, they went into turn 1 side by side, and you see what happens. It hurt both of them.
backed him up about 8 car lengths from the field in front. And the car in front of them, the number 50 of Derek Cope. As you look at Darlington from above, and Junior looks for second place and gets it.
He's really happy. Junior is really happy with that car. I'm telling you, he was just bragging on it last night.
And he had a great run at Rockingham last month. This racetrack, a lot of similar characteristics to Rockingham, where he had a top five finish.
It does so much for a driver and a team. When you can have a weekend like they had in Vegas, and you can come back the next week and win the race, I'm telling you, that puts a lot of wind in your sails right there, buddy.
Brian Vickers under Scott Riggs.
Battle for 29th position. Brian Vickers started right there at 28th. We've not had a lot of moving around as far as position changes just yet.
Yeah, most of the time it's early in the race. You're not looking to race anybody. Right now, you truly are trying to tell the crew what you need for the car.
The Cinderella story of this race is Derek Cope, the 1990 Daytona 500 winner. He was good in practice and backed it up with a qualifying effort, put him up in the first three rows. The Arnold Development car, a couple races ago, had redneckjunk.com, a classified ad site for hunting, fishing, and car and pickup truck gear. NASCAR requested they take that sponsor off the hood, and the resulting publicity did great things for the website, which now just calls itself rjunk.com. That car's not junk, though. Derek is giving it a good ride.
Yeah, I mean, he's back in that qualifying run up. He has a lot of pressure right now from Rusty Wallace in the 2 and Jeff Gordon in the 24, but he's still sitting there solidly in the top 10. I think that's what everybody was wondering. Can they back that qualifying run up here today on race day?
Jeff Burton has come from 33rd to 25th. One of the cars on the move.
Yeah, he had a great run yesterday as well, you know, in the Busch race, finished second. So Roush cars traditionally run good here. Jeff, what you got, buddy?
One of the things right now, Darrell, is watching again, Jeff Burton. Remember, you talked about him a minute ago. He ran that Busch race along with Robbie Gordon in less than 6 laps. So these guys have gained a ton of positions from 33rd up to 25th. They're really on the move.
And, of course, the real challenge these guys have, they have good race cars, Darrell, but you're back there having to run the car so hard, you're a third of the lap behind the leaders, and you're starting to use your stuff up just trying to fight through this traffic.
One of the things that NASCAR is doing, and I think it's a pretty good idea, Michael's in the wall down in turns 3 and 4, and he's going around into the wall.
Caution is out. Morgan Shepherd in 89 just barely gets by, and I tell you, these guys have to be wondering, where is it going to stop at?
Yeah, ever since September of last year, this is the way his cars look most of the time.
Caution out beginning lap 9. Here at Darlington, Michael Waltrip gets caught up. And
it looks like the car, I was looking at it, and I glanced up to see it just gets loose going in. He tries to catch up with it. Not enough room here to chase a car up the hill. Gets clipped in the left front, turns it back into the outside wall.
First caution of the day comes early at Darlington, South Carolina.
23 years old, trying for his first Nextel Cup Series win. He says the car is a little skating. They were going to make a track bar adjustment as the butt guys are already on the left side of Junior Chevrolet. He's down and away. A good stop going so far by Casey Kane's crew, and he is going to be close. Junior's going to get him off pit road.
Yeah, the Casey Kane stop was just a little bit slow, and it's like he couldn't get going when he went to leave his pit box.
And Larry, this one I don't like about the tires that we got this year versus what we had last year. Guys would not come to pit road last year for tires at 11 laps. And here we are, 11 laps, 4 tires.
One driver who did not stop was Greg Biffle. He is the leader. Michael Waltrip sits in the garage. Dick Bergman.
Well, Michael Waltrip has had a very, very tough weekend. He has crashed practice, he crashed in qualifying, and now again in the race. What just happened to you, Michael?
We cut a left rear tire getting then into 3. As soon as I let off, it started vibrating and lost control of the Napa Auto Parts Chevy. It's been a terrible year, Dick. I'd like to take a second and thank Napa, Klausner Furniture, Oreo Cookies, Best Western, Domino's, all of our sponsors, because y'all haven't got to talk about me any, and that's been very disappointing. Domino's is wanting to get $5 away for us to everybody if we just finish in the top 10. But, Dick, I'm the same man that won the Daytona 500 a year ago, and we were sitting third in the points here at Darlington after we left. I'm still focused, and it's hard to accept. That was just out of the blue, left rear flat. And as soon as I let off, it turned around on me.
Mikey, better days are ahead, I promise.
Let's ride with Michael Waltrip.
Just like you said, you see the back step out, nowhere to go, not enough room here to save one. And I think it was Morgan Shepherd that plowed into him. And I don't think it hurt Morgan's car that much, but Mikey's having a bad go of it right now, but it can turn around, go the other way just as easy.
38th at Daytona, 33rd at Rockingham, 37th at Las Vegas, 23rd at Atlanta, his best finish of the season. Steve Burns, Greg Biffle did not pit.
Yeah, let's wrap this all up, Mike. Just before the race, crew chief Doug Richard told his crew, his over-the-wall guys, do not take your helmets off today. You never know when something's going to happen. We have to be ready for anything. Well, when the caution came out, they decided, they being Greg and Doug, not to pit because of an upcoming caution. But when everybody else came to pit road, Doug Richard said, uh-oh, we're in trouble.
Yeah, I mean, and those competitors, they only had 10 laps on their tires, as Greg Biffle does. There was other cars that stayed out, Todd Bodine, Joe Ruttman, Kirk Shelmerdine, and Kyle Petty, but now they've come to pit road, so pretty much Dale Earnhardt Jr. with fresh tires will be right behind Greg Biffle in the 16 car. And let's watch Casey Kane's pit stop. Remember, he has that very last pit box as you leave pit road, but he comes to his box, to the attention of his crew. It's going to be four tires. Just one miscue right there. That just goes to show you. It kind of throws the stop off sequence right there because they didn't have his tire there for him.
Yeah. I just don't think they were ready. You know, I don't think some of these teams thought they were going to come that early, just 10 laps into the race.
Casey Kane, only the fourth rookie to start on the pole at Darlington, joining Charlie Glotzbach in 68, Davey Allison in 87, and Kurt Busch 3 years ago. Time for our Singular Wireless virtual crew chief question. Vote now from your Singular phone. Send text message FOX to phone number 191 or visit foxsports.com to vote online.
Hey, Jeff, let me ask you something, buddy. You know, the 48 car picked a pit back down here toward the first turn area. How did he fare? Did he come out good? Did he come out bad? Did that work out for him?
It was about a trade-off right now, Darrell. In this first pit round of pit stops, he came in running 10th. Todd Bodine is still in the racetrack along with Greg Biffle, and he's wound up being right now 13th. So about a trade-off right there. I don't believe he lost anything. He definitely didn't gain any.
Michael Waltrip's the only car in the garage as we restart to begin lap 15.
Yeah, all cars are on the lead lap. That's the reason it was a single file restart. And just remember, Greg Biffle, the only car that did not pit. He has 10 more laps on his tires than Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the A car. We'll see if he can hold him off. Darrell, I think several cars are going to get by him, but hopefully he'll find a place somewhere there in the top 10 to fall in line.
I believe if he can hold enough of them off here for a few laps, let the new wear off of the guys that stopped tires, he'll balance out here in the top 7 or 8, I believe.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the A car, he'll get his 5 bonus points for leading, and there you see the battle for second place between Casey Kane in the 9 and Greg Biffle in the 16. Casey Kane will prevail. But I think Doug Richard was thinking, hey, I think with only 9 laps, we'll have some cars stay out. I'm sitting here thinking maybe the top 15 will stay out.
Yeah, Dick Bergen, I think you're down there near the 48 car, Jimmy Johnson's pit. Why did they pick that pit, Doc?
Well, I asked Chad Knaus that exact question this morning before the race started, Darrell. And let's remember back to last May at Lowe's Motor Speedway. They had that pit way up toward turn 4. The outcome was they won the race. Knaus likes that pit because nobody's going to be in front of him coming into the pit. He's also got a car in front of him that he expects is going to be a lap down early. As a result, he'll be able to get out of the pits very quickly. So a lot of good reasons to pick that pit way up here in turn 4.
Yeah, he's able to get there and get his work completed. Then all he has to worry about is staying out against the outside wall of pit road, maintaining that 45 miles per hour.
Johnson side by side with Bobby Labonte. That's for 11th place. Dale Earnhardt Jr. is our leader. It's the third race he has led this year. Let's see. He's won 2, so that means every time he's led, he's won.
Got a good car, I know that. They were all up in the air about how good the car was, especially even on the long run. So we'll see how it works out for him.
And I tell you, Greg Biffle in the 16 car, he just continues to lose position. He just lost a position to Jeff Gordon in the 24, as well as Ward Burton in the zero. Jeff, I'm sure Doug Richard never anticipated they would be the only one not to pit.
I know he was surprised, but the other thing that kind of confuses me, Doug, about what Doug did, Larry, is the fact that that car, you know, qualifying in the top 10, had to start on his qualifying tires. So his tires had an opportunity to set since Friday. I know a lot of the guys, especially Fatback and Swain, he said, I can't wait to get a chance to get those things off. So he took advantage of it, and right now, Greg Biffle's paying the price.
Guess that explains why all those leaders came in at lap 9, maybe?
Yeah, the NASCAR rule is if you qualify in the top 10, you have to start on those qualifiers. They impound those tires after qualifying. I talked to Michael Fatback McSwain this morning. He said, I've told Bobby Labonte, if you can't qualify on the pole, qualify 11th or worse.
Yeah, and I think that's a rule that they need to look at. Larry and I were talking about this yesterday. That's an old school. We used to take the top 10 because they were checking them, make sure nobody did anything to them. They got so many checks and balances now, nobody's going to do anything to the tires they qualify on.
Junior, 7/10 of a second up on Casey Kane.
Plus, it's a huge disadvantage. Why does a guy who's qualifying the top 10 got to start on the tires he qualified on when you know that's a disadvantage?
So it sounds like it should be everybody?
Or nobody, exactly.
Matt.
Mike, young Casey Kane continues to impress. This was the first racetrack this season that he didn't have a chance to test because NASCAR and ISC, the track owner, were putting in the new safer walls. So he had to rely more on his Busch experience here, and he won the pole. The car, a little skatey. Tommy Baldwin of Scrucci said it should take about 10 to 12 laps for it to settle in. Remember the egg from Rockingham, Vegas, and Atlanta. Also, one other thing to keep in mind, NASCAR was talking about a competition yellow about lap 40, so if your car is not right, we'll adjust it again.
Well, Matt, I guarantee you Greg Biffle is looking for lap 40 right now. He can't wait for that competition caution to come out where he can get those tires off of his car.
Casey Kane, the pole sitter, and back to the front.
And that was a gimme. He's faster than the 8 car, Dale Jr. So Casey just blows by him, and Dale Jr. says, I'll follow you a while, young man. You look like you're running pretty good.
You don't race each other this early in the race.
No,
if they caught you, they caught you for a reason.
Tell that to Elliott Sadler as he blasts underneath Rusty Wallace to take 6th place.
Well, you got, you know, back there, you got to pass them when you catch them. One right. Thing about new tires, you got to take advantage of them while the car feels good. You got to go like crazy.
Three laps in for the Carolina Dodge Dealers 400. Casey Kane over Dale Earnhardt Jr. and Kurt Busch as Joe Rutland goes to the garage. And by Viagra. Ask your doctor if Viagra is right for you. Caution is out at lap 28. Andy Hillenberg, lapped car, spun, and Jeff Gordon, who came in here 5th in the Nextel Cup points, piled into Hillenberg. Jeff is okay. Let's show you what happened.
Well, the 80 car's up there in the groove, and here comes Tony, and Tony gives him a little tap, trying to get him down out of the way, and he turns him around, and Jeff, you just can't turn down right there. There's no way to stop. There's no way to turn. Jeff was hoping maybe the 80 would go down the hill. He could get by on the outside, but it just did not happen for him.
And Jeff had Elliott Sadler right underneath him.
He was forced to up to the high side, and then the only thing he could hope for was that 80 car would slide down the hill.
And I think a split second later, he would have slid down the hill.
Yep. Just in the wrong place at the wrong time.
See, Gordon started a turn down, but there was just no way to clear him. Jamie McMurray scoots through on the apron.
This is all happening down there in the center of the corner at about 150, 60 miles per hour.
The lap previous, two cars that had trouble getting by Hillenberg had to really woe up on the brakes and go underneath them.
Cars do hit the wall here and go down, but it takes them a little bit longer because your corner speed is so slow. You're not going fast enough through the corner to hit the wall, and it shoots you to the down the racetrack. You kind of hit it and then go along and then slide down.
Jeff Gordon comes in here 5th in points, 22 starts here, 14 top 10 finishes, but it won't happen today, and that's going to be a big hit for him in this points.
He will join Michael Waltrip and Joe Ruttman in the garage. The man that Hillenburg
really wanted this caution was Greg Biffle, who restarted this race leading it about 20 laps ago. He had fell back to 19th. So I think, once again, when pit road's open, everyone will come get those four fresh tires.
Not a lot of damage to Tony's car, but I wonder, Darrell, could he have shown more patience in getting past Hillenburg?
Well, the guys like Tony that are running hard and, you know, up to speed, they are a little bit impatient with the cars that they're already lapping, you know, in 8 and 10 and 12 laps. It's frustration on his part. Dick.
Well, the first thing Jimmy Johnson wanted to know when he got on his radio was, how's Jeff? Jeff Gordon, his good buddy, his friend, his car as well. Minor changes to Johnson's race car. He's got a good one, and he is on his way out already.
Ryan Newman has been complaining that his car is just a little bit tight, so they made a wedge adjustment. Now they take some tape off the nose. Matt Yoakum.
Leader Casey Kane, no adjustments as they're on the left side of Dale Earnhardt Jr. Chevrolet. He's down and away. No adjustments for Casey Kane. Tommy Baldwin wants to leave car alone on this run just to see how this car reacted, because they haven't had a lot of green flag laps. And also, this caution, NASCAR tells teams, will cancel the lap 40 mandatory caution.
Let's update you, too, on Greg Biffle, the fellow who really needed this caution, as Casey Kane's crew is a lot happier with their performance this time around. Biffle got the pit stop he needed and got his tires. He's going to be around 20th place.
Yeah, Greg Biffle and Doug Richard was the poster child. Everybody saw what happened to them. Everyone came to pit road that time.
Show you the battle off pit road. Won by Casey Kane.
Tell you what, for the second stop in a row, Ryan Newman, that 12 group, they came to life on pit road during their pit stop.
Kurt Busch right there. You saw Burton go by having a good day here in the top 10. Now, much happier crew this time around.
Happens to you once, not your fault. Happens to you twice, nobody's fault but yours. It didn't happen that time.
Todd Bodine gives up the lead to make a pit stop. Kyle Petty has had an extended stay on pit road. Look at the right rear. Some suspension damage in the rear of that car. Also some damage to the rear of Jeremy Mayfield. Didn't get our bumper cam, but did a lot of damage there to the left rear.
I think the 99 may have done that, because I saw the 99 in pulling the nose out. Got a tail bent, a nose bent. They go together.
Darrell, again, let's look at the start of this and what happened between Tony Stewart and Andy Hillenburg.
Well, of course, Tony, you got to respect every race car on the racetrack. And he runs up on this slow car, and I know he's probably thinking, you know, this guy needs to get out of my way. I'm a fast car. And he wanted to send him a message. What he was trying to do is say, look, feller, don't get in my way anymore. So he gives him a little nerf, gets him out of control, and the guy looks for Tony the next time, but he just got into him a little too hard.
Of course, along comes Jeff Gordon in the 24 car, just nowhere to go. As you said, DW, you thought that the 80 car, he thought the 80 car was going to go down the racetrack.
Well, after 2 years ago, where Tony got into an incident here with a lapped car, that may account for a little bit of lack of patience.
Yeah, this is Buckshot Jones in the 44 car. And again, Tony just was closing. You got to remember something. The closing right here is huge. And you're coming up on the guy, and you're anticipating. Come on, come on, come on, come on, move. And he doesn't move, and you're into him.
Dick Bergman.
With Andy Hillenburg, what happened out there, Andy?
I wiggled up in front of the 20 car there, and I mean, you know, you come in here, and this is the big boys, and slow car and a fast car, and fast car hits a slow car, and it's a slow car's fault, and we'll go back and build us a faster car, and someday we'll be back, and we'll be the faster car.
Is he okay in there?
I'm fine. Sorry for Jeff Gordon. I feel bad. It's a race car driver's worst nightmares to come here and take out one of the heroes, and all the Gordon fans, sorry.
And, of course, we mentioned a while ago, Jeff Gordon comes into this race fifth in points, 130 points behind leader Matt Kenseth. And remember, it's a 26-race season right now, this chase for the championship, to be within 400 points of that leader at the end of 26 races. So still a long way to go, but he'll take a hard hit today on the points.
And then feel really sorry for Andy. I mean, he's just trying to be, you know, he wants to be in the show. He wants to be a part of the show. He is not the show. The stars are the show. He just wanted to be a part of it, and he gets himself in a situation there that really was not of his own making.
I get the feeling he accepted the responsibility, but he went, not the blame.
I think you're exactly right, Mike. Well put.
Next week's NASCAR race menu is brought to you by Wendy's Classic Hamburgers. It's better here. Saturday, live from Bristol, NASCAR Busch Series Racing presented by Taco Bell, 1 o'clock Eastern on Fox. Next Sunday, don't miss America's Best Drivers in the NASCAR Nextel Cup Series presented by Quaker State at 1 p.m. Eastern on Fox.
And if you think it's tough here, all the rules out to win the next weekend at the fastest half-mile racetrack.
Quick.
Everyone on four fresh tires now, but right now Ryan Newman in that 12 car, he knows he has those fresh tires. Darrell, I'm going to take advantage of it right now and lead this thing.
No question about that 12 having it. Ryan Newman got the steam under the hood. Those Penske engines put out some power.
Right now, Casey Kane in the 9, he's just not getting going on this restart as he loses second position to Kurt Busch in the 97. And Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the 8 car, we're looking at him right here, he wants that third position.
I noticed Kane's a little slow on the restarts. Gets really three or four or five laps. He starts coming back, though, and starts to pull away.
Boy, Dale Earnhardt Jr. so he's in trouble right there. He had to get completely out of the throttle. He's going to lose three more positions, fall all the way back to 6 before he can gather it back up.
That turn is all momentum. You got to stay in the gas coming off there. If you get shoved up, get out of the gas, man. They go flying by you left and right.
And here comes Rusty underneath Dale Jr. Not going to complete the pass this time.
So what happens over here up high, right here where Kane goes, the 9 car, that's all dirt. That's it. That's debris. All there is sand and dirt and rubber off the tires there already, and he gets out on those tires, and the car is uncontrollable.
We did get the word that NASCAR sent word to Dale Earnhardt Jr. in 8 car. It's early. Settle down just a little bit right now.
Jimmy Johnson flew past Ward Burton coming off turn number 2. Jimmy will pick up the 8th place. Darrell, that turn 2 area especially, if one driver can't get back on the gas, as happened to Andy Hillenburg, got a little loose, the next driver is on him so quickly, even when it's not lap cars, even when it's cars racing for position, it looks like it's real easy to just run over top of somebody there.
It is, and we're going to see more and more examples of that as the day goes along. We'll be able to dissect that turn a little bit more, but that's a difficult, most difficult place on the racetrack. Coming down out of that turn, wide open, and all of a sudden you got to burp it a little bit, and here comes the other guy. He taps you, and there's nowhere to go but around and into the fence.
Watching Jamie McMurray in the 42 car, he's back in 12th position. His teammate, Sterling Marlin, in the 40 car. A lot of teams this morning in the garage area said they really was impressed with Sterling's long run yesterday. And remember, he had that top 5 finish at Rockingham last month. There you see right now how far McMurray and Marlin in the 40 are behind our leader right now, Ryan Newman. And it equates to about a fourth of a lap.
You know, Larry, I always tell the folks at home, we use the start-finish line for it. That's our preference. And so when I'm out there racing and I'm leading the race or wherever I'm running, that's the point I want my crew chief, Jeff or whoever, to say, leader at the line now. Because 3 or 4 seconds doesn't mean a whole lot to me when I'm in the car, but I know where the line is and I know where I am and I know kind of what track position I have.
Darrell, I believe you're right now. Casey Kane in the 9, he fell back to 6th position. Now, after 3 or 4 laps, he's starting to pick positions back up. He just went by Tony Stewart in the 20 car, and actually Tony just lost another position to Rusty Wallace in the 2.
Dick Bergeron is with Jeff Gordon.
Just come out of the care center. How are you?
I'm sore. I tell you, I hadn't taken a hit like that in a long time, if ever. So, you know, I hate it that it happened. I mean, the car was just really starting to come to me in long race here at Darlington. Last thing you want is an incident like that. And, you know, I know it wasn't Andy Hillenburg's, you know, fault, but there's a lot of guys out there that don't belong out there that are just so far off the pace that, you know, on a narrow track like this, something needs to be done about that. But, you know, our day's over and we'll just go on to the next one.
6-time winner here at Darlington, a real tough day today.
And then what Jeff is saying is on a track like this, it's a single groove racetrack. It's hard enough to drive a good fast car here. It's miserable to try to drive a slow car here and stay out of people's way. Every time you move down out of the way, you pick up debris on your tires, makes the car drive that much worse, goes that much slower.
Kyle Petty had a long pit stop and continues to lose ground with that car in the garage. Steve?
And Mike, we watched the team try to push Kyle Petty's car into the garage. The rear wheels absolutely would not turn. In fact, they had the rear wheels as they pull the left rear tire off on a creeper. And we've been told that a gear broke. Kyle is still in the race car right now, and it looks like they may change the entire rear end housing and assembly.
Yeah, I mean, Steve, this place can be hard on a gear. I mean, you always, you're in the throttle so long in the corner and the rear end's almost in a bind, it can be hard on that gear.
I believe he broke the rear end housing, Larry, just looking at the car laying on the ground the way it was. I think the whole housing broke off.
They are working to get back in the race. In the garage, Todd Bodine, Jeff Gordon, Andy Hillenburg, Joe Rutman, and Michael Waltrip, whose car is still under repair as well. Ryan Newman and Kurt Busch there. 1-2. Dodge, Ford, Chevy with Earnhardt Jr. third. Casey Kane, Elliott Sadler, Rusty Wallace, Tony Stewart, Jeremy Mayfield, Jimmy Johnson, and Ward Burton are the top 10 in Darlington. NASCAR Nextel Cup Racing on Fox is brought to you by UPS, the official express delivery company of NASCAR. We want to race the truck. People love the truck. One laps complete. Ryan Newman leading Kurt Busch and Dale Earnhardt Jr. Quaker State aerial coverage. You see the egg shape, and at the top of your screen, the minnow pond, the Ramsey Brothers Pond, where some of our Fox cameramen have pulled a few out this weekend. Attaboy. And that's why this track has such a unique shape. They couldn't build it in a conventional oval figuration because of the pond at one corner and Highway 151 alongside what is now the backstretch. Steve.
Hey, Mike, Ryan Newman said he caught a bass yesterday after happy hour in that very pond that weighed over 6 pounds. He didn't keep it. I said, how do you know? He said, hey, man, I had a scale with me, proving that he is, in fact, an engineering graduate. Ryan Newman saying his car is just a tick loose off of turn four.
And I tell you, there's such boy. Kurt Busch was just a tick loose off of turn four that time, too, in that 97 car, and the caution is out.
Debris is the reason. Kurt Schelmerdine just pulled his car to the garage. This is a big trash bag in turn three, which didn't oblige us by flying over the fence. So rather than get it on the grill or windshield of a race car, we're under caution for the third time in Darlington. Welcome back to NASCAR Nextel Cup Racing on Fox. Caution out for the third time today. Debris down at turn number three, and now the pits are open. Everybody will head for pit road. Ryan Newman leads our Dodge front runners, who are first, fourth, and sixth. And among the quick Dodges, Dick Berggren.
And that's Jeremy Mayfield, who started out in 18th position, but he has been rolling forward. He was 7th when that caution flag came out. Said the car is rolling too much to the right rear to suit him, so they're going to put a little bit more weight in the left rear. Steve Burns.
Brian Newman says his car is just a little bit loose. Chassis adjustment, wedge in the left rear, 2 rounds. Dennis Terry and Joe Payette change tires. Matt.
Kurt Busch says the car is still both loose and tight. As the 12 is down and out, they're already on the left side of the inner chassis adjustment. For the 97 is the 8 car. Dale Jr. down and away. He's going to beat the 12 off the road. The 97 is going to pull out around the 9. 97 is going to win the battle off pit road.
And look at this log jam, 2 abreast as they funnel off pit road. Wow.
These guys on pit road are phenomenal. I mean, I challenge anyone to say these guys changing tires in 12, 13 seconds are not athletes.
And the other thing is, Larry, again, I just want to keep talking about the tires. Last year, there would have been some debate about what to do right there. You maybe come get 2, maybe come and not get any. But they've taken the pressure off the crew chiefs with the tire we got now, because it's back like it used to be. Caution comes out after 2 or 3 laps, you come and get 4 tires. Not much decision making to be done in the pits right now.
It's easy to be a crew chief here on race day.
Yeah, well,
as long as you can hold 4 fingers up, you're good.
It wasn't, last couple of years, we've had strategy, but now there's no strategy.
Pit stops complete after this third caution, and Kurt Busch is the leader. His crew gets to celebrate a little bit. Getting set for the green flag, and it waves. To begin lap 59, Morgan Shepherd led a lap under caution, and the 62-year-old driver pits. Surrenders the lead. We're back under green with Kurt Busch out front.
Quick, quick, quick. Turn that surround sound wide open. Let's crank it up.
Petty and Michael Waltrip are both back into the race at lap 61. Pit stop under green for Andy Belmont. Morgan Shepherd about to be inhaled by the leader, Kurt Busch. Shepherd's green, number 89, goes a lap down. Second place the race.
Seems to be pretty solid behind this second place race right here between Dale Earnhardt Jr. and Casey Kane. Ryan Newman's going to make it a three-car race, but right behind them, Elliott Sadler in that 38 car. That car has been solid here all weekend long. They're trying to redeem themselves. They felt like at Atlanta, they had a car in happy hour that could win the race. They had an equalized tire at the beginning of the race and never overcame that. Had a terrible run all day long, but a good run here.
Junior's car looks a little bit different. Junior's car looks a little bit like it did at Atlanta, where it's pretty fast on these restarts, fades a little bit, but Atlanta, they were able to adjust it up and get it real good at the end of the day. We'll see how it turns out here.
You were looking back from Casey Kane at Elliott Sadler. Ryan Newman there, third place, Kane fourth, Sadler fifth. Then the Chevys of Stewart, Johnson, and Burton. The Dodges of Wallace, McMurray, Mayfield, and Marlin. That's the top dozen. Matt?
Elliott Sadler working on his fourth top 10 Tarlington finish in the last five races here. He said on lap two something he's been saying all day. No grip. They have worked on that. The last stop, they went down on air pressure, all four tires, and made a track bar adjustment to help the tightness in the center of the corner. To Steve Burns.
Hey, Matt, Tony Stewart is running sixth, but to hear him on the radio, you'd think he was having an awful day. Under caution, he said to crew chief Greg Zipadelli and the team, if you guys have any ideas on what I can do, I'm listening. They're running all over me out here. I can't turn the car, and I can't get into the gas coming off the corner. To try and fix him up, they took some air on the left side tires and took some wedge out.
That's Darlington. That's how everybody's car feels. That's one of those things you just have to deal with. Nobody's car feels good here.
Hey, whose feels pretty good right now, especially through the center of the corners. You see Kurt Busch looking from Dale Earnhardt Jr., the leader right now, wiggle off turn four. We've been seeing that a lot. But Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s car is so strong right here when they go to pick the throttle up. But they pick the throttle up well before the center of one and two. Then you have to roll back out over in turn two, pick it up as quick as you can. But he wants to lead back that Budweiser car.
Yeah, and Kurt knows he's having to drive way, way too hard, taking too many chances to stay keep Jr. behind him. So he pulls over and lets him go. I think that's a wise decision right at this point. That was probably directed from the spotter or the crew chief one.
Here's Matt.
Junior made his move going into three and four, and he's telling his crew chief, Tony Urey Sr., that's really been his worst area of the racetrack. He is much better down in one and two, especially off turn two. That's where they worked a lot in the final practice session to make sure he was the most comfortable, because Junior felt like that's where he's going to have to set people up to make his pass so he can take that lead going down into three.
I mean, turn two is such a huge corner. I mean, it goes forever over there. And if there is, every corner is important, but Darrell, if there is a pretty important corner, it would be turn two.
I always told the guys, I said, I wish somebody go over and put a big X on the wall that this is where you make that second hitch. Because you turn into one, then you go straight for a little while, then you got to make another big left-hand turn to come off of two. And if you miss it, it's junk. You got to lift out the throttle. But if you hit it, man, you're sailing down that back straightaway.
Next caution, we'll want to show you all the rubber that's been put down already in turn two, both on the asphalt and on the wall. Morgan Shepherd has taken his John Deere number 89 to the garage. Kurt Busch there in second over Ryan Newman by just a couple of car lengths. Chevy, Ford, Dodge, Dodge. Casey Kane fourth, Elliott Sadler's Ford in fifth, then the three Chevys, Stewart, Johnson, and Burton.
You know, it's so important to qualify up front here. 90% of the races are won from cars that start in the top 15. 80-some percent of the races are won from cars that start in the top 5. So starting up front is critical, and you can see why. You're out in clean air, nobody in your way. You get a little gap between you and the guy running second, third, or whatever, and you don't have to force the issue all the time.
You guys talk about qualifying in the top 15. A car I've been watching very closely, Ward Burton, in this zero car right here. He qualified in 13th. And Steve Burns, he always runs well here, and it looks pretty solid today. He's up to 8th.
He sure does, Larry Mack. He's got two wins on this tough old racetrack. He said the front end of the car is sliding just a little bit. He's really good coming off of turn four.
But as you guys talked about, he's a little bit tight coming off of turn two. They made an air pressure adjustment and changed four tires on that last stop.
He's got quite a battle right here with Jamie McMurray that's no longer a battle in the 42 car. But Darrell, we talked about it in the beginning. This racetrack got washed down last night. I think now the racetrack is getting back to where it was in happy hour. And I think the more rubber gets down, the worse the car wants to turn.
Yeah, you're starting to see that black kind of glow that the track gets on it once they get rubber down on it. And that just keeps picking up, getting worse and worse. And it will change the setup on the car.
Casey Kane now having a look at Ryan Newman. This is for third place.
Yeah, Kane really gets going on the long runs. That's where that car is so strong.
And I've been watching the score monitor. He by far is running the quickest laps right now of anyone, including our leader, Dale Earnhardt Jr., as he tries to pull to the inside of Ryan Newman in the 12. This is where you try to have that give and take right there, but Ryan was able to keep the momentum on the high side.
Yeah, you know, I think if I was Ryan, I would, you see how squirrely he got coming off turn four. When a guy catches you here, you need to pull over and let him go on the straightaway.
See Casey Kane in the 9, a little bit of braking in the corner right here, feathering that throttle. You can't pick it wide open. The car won't take it all the way out of it right in the middle of turn 2, finally wide open throttle all the way up on the back stretch.
Casey Kane trailing Newman. They're trailing Kurt Busch, who is 8-tenths of a second behind Dale Earnhardt Jr., the leader in the Carolina Dodge Dealers 400.
Welcome back to Darlington, and log on to FoxSports.com or visit Visa.com to find out how you can win Visa's Ultimate NASCAR experience at the Michigan 400 in June with Jeff Hamlin, Chris Myers at the Hollywood Hotel. Nice to have you with us on Fox. They've been racing for just about an hour. Michael Waltrip on lap 9 into the wall after a cut left rear tire. Crashed in practice and in qualifying and a face of frustration, but he is back in this race. And then Andy Hillenberg with a... Well, getting in the way of Tony Stewart, and then Jeff Gordon smacks into him. Hillenberg apologizing later, saying he hates to see Gordon out of the race. Gordon said he hadn't felt a hit like that in quite some time. And pit stops here, helping to make a difference in the lead change. Kurt Busch taking the lead. Dale Earnhardt Jr. on lap 67 taking the lead. Then Kurt Busch taking the lead back. And Kurt Busch, Jeff Hamlin, the guy who was runner-up by a hundredth of a second, if we can call it that, in last year's exciting race with Ricky Craven. And Kurt, your leader there.
Well, I think Kurt really believes right now that this racetrack kind of owes him one. And you got to think about it like this also, Chris. This racetrack has been very good to Roush Racing. Both Mark Martin and Jeff Burton have been winners here in the past, so I would not be surprised to see Kurt Busch get the victory lane today.
In Saturday's Busch race, it was Roush cars 1 and 2. Dale Earnhardt Jr. Hot on his heels. You see Ryan Newman passing Dale Earnhardt Jr. for the second spot, and Casey Kane running for it.
Well, again, it looked like these guys are just kind of like give and take a little bit. You race the racetrack here at Darlington. A lot of times it's easier to let a guy go and kind of conserve yourself. Later on, you get back to him and be able to get back by him. So they're just using really good, smart racing right now here at Darlington.
As we get a view from a junior's 8 car, this has been a Visa race break. Let's rejoin Larry, Darrell, and Mike.
Among the front 5, score 1 for youth and enthusiasm. The oldest of the front 5, Dale Earnhardt Jr. in third place, age 29. You got to go back to 6th place Tony Stewart to find a driver in his 30s, and 10th place Ward Burton for a driver in his 40s. 23-year-old Casey Kane puts the move on Junior and goes to third.
Looks like to me, DW's young guns are dominating this thing as we're almost a third of the way. But I want to go back and we want to update right now our 13th place car, Greg Biffle, in the 16. Remember, back on lap 9, he was the only lead lap car that elected to stay out. And he worked his way back to about 19th before he was finally able to get 4 tires on it. But I've been watching his lap times. He has a very quick race car, but his teammate, Matt Kenseth, who qualified back in 15th, he's just been quietly hanging there, Steve, not making a lot of noise, but just being solid.
Larry, I talked to his crew chief, Robbie Reiser, this morning, and he said that they were loose off of turn 4 all weekend. That was a concern, and that has stayed consistent. They're a little tight getting into the corners. Maybe a minor problem that could get worse later. His Matt's radio piece is loose, and when he keys the mic, it is extremely difficult for the team to hear what Matt is saying.
Thanks, Steve. There are the Roush cars and where they are positioned, with Kurt Busch leading. How about last year's winner, Ricky Craven, who started this race toward the back of the field? How's he fared today, Dick Berggren?
Oh, not very well, Mike Joy. He is running well back in the pack in 32nd spot right now, and he too had radio problems early in this event. He just called into his crew and said the car is out of balance. Somebody passes him, and he just slides through the turn. He has also complained about the car understeering, pushing. So Craven from the state of Maine, but a tough day today.
34 cars on the lead lap, and Darrell, let's not count out the veterans. Here's a pack of them in hot contention.
Well, I've been watching particularly Terry Labonte in the 5 car, and Rusty seems like he's got a little problem right now, but Terry has been sitting back there in a little zone all his own. He may not have the car to win the race, but he's driving this race the way a veteran would drive it. This is the closest I've seen him to anybody since we started the race. He's got Ricky Rudd in front of him and Rusty Wallace behind him, 21 and 2. I think he feels pretty comfortable running with those guys, knowing they're not going to do anything dumb, make a Darlington mistake like a lot of guys do.
Labonte, defending champion of the fall race here, the Southern 500.
But, Darrell, they cannot fool around long, because right now this race has that green flag look about it, and they're only 10 seconds in front of our leader right now, Kurt Busch, and he's running quite a bit quicker than those guys.
But when the leader starts to catch up with traffic, Larry, I mean, it slows them down so much. I mean, you can lose a couple of seconds a lap here dealing with a slow car or a lap car, because you just lose your momentum. Single groove racetrack, hard to pass.
Andy Belmont has joined Morgan Shepherd in the garage area, along with Kirk Shelmerdine, Todd Bodine, Jeff Gordon, Andy Hillenburg, and Joe Ruttman. Kyle Petty, Michael Waltrip, running many laps down. Waltrip after that crash at lap 9, and Kyle Petty having problems with the rear end, which they replaced in the garage. Everybody else on the lead lap. Kurt Busch, 1.4 seconds up on Ryan Newman. There's rookie Brendan Gaughan behind Busch, who has just become the first car one lap down.
There's one thing you know about Darlington. If you test it often enough, you'll probably flunk the test more than you pass it. So driving on the edge here, you cannot do that lap after lap and expect to survive.
Busch the leader, Newman second, Casey Kane, Dale Earnhardt Jr. is fourth. Matt?
Dale Jr. still hovering in the top five on that last stop back on lap 56. Jr. said the car was snug on entry and in the center. Not too bad an exit, just a little bit free in the center down in 3 and 4. They made a chassis adjustment and pulled the spring rubber, but what they did, they rotated the loose condition from the center now to entry. Jr. says the car is just too loose when he tries to make his arc into the corner, currently in the fourth position.
A little telemetry on Dale Jr. You see the speed and the gap to the race leader.
And you hear how he's feathering that thing.
Larry, what about the driver who swept both ends of the Winston Cup season here in 1999?
Yeah, I mean, he qualified back in 33rd, Jeff Burton, in the 99. He's worked his way back up to 17th. Remember, he had that front end damage. His crew worked on it and put him near the rear of the field. But I think Jeff Burton, who ran second in yesterday's Busch race, Darrell, it's a typical Jeff Burton run. He likes those long green runs. His car don't give up as much as others.
Yeah, he's got a new crew chief, and looks like, you know, it might take them a race or two to get their communication worked out. But by the same token, he's coming to a place where he can give good feedback, which is going to make the crew chief's job a lot easier.
Yeah, Paul Andrews was released this week as a crew chief, and Roush went a different direction with this car. He put his chief engineer, Bob Osborne.
Absolutely, no pressure from behind. Just race the racetrack. Keep doing what you're doing.
That's his spotter telling him, no pressure from behind. In other words, don't worry about what's behind you, because right now no one is behind you. But Bob Osborne has been named the crew chief and has been with Roush since 1999, the chief engineer.
And again, you get in that zone. The veterans get in a zone. They're by themselves, nobody in front, nobody behind, and you just kind of run your own race.
Boy, this kid's been in a zone, like the end zone. Second, third. Last three races for Casey Kane. Matt?
And Casey Kane continues to show about 0.1 to 0.2 faster a lap than leader, the 97 car, Kurt Busch. Over the past two runs, Casey says the car is just way too free, way loose on that right rear tire. Tommy Baldwin didn't make a chassis adjustment on the last stop, but what he did, he went to a different set of tires that had a stagger very close to the set of tires that Casey had on his second run. Three, four laps ago, Tommy keyed the mic and said, Casey, why don't you dial a little front brake into it and see if that helps? Now, how is Casey Let's go to Jeff Hammond for more.
What Casey Kane is going to try to do with those instructions from his crew chief, he's going to actually take a novice that mounted on the dash, and he's going to adjust these brakes here. This is what you call a dual master cylinder, and what it is, this is the front, this is the rear. What he will do is turn that knob and change the pressure from the front and the rear balance. That's what he's looking to do, is to make more front brake grip, so when he goes down in the corner, the car will actually stop more on the front brake than it will on the rear. What you're doing is just changing the braking percentage from the front to the rear. Daryl?
Yeah, one of the things that this place really rewards is good physical conditioning, because you got to stay sharp here all day long, and good, quick hand-eye coordination. Because you're going to get a little loose every now and then. The car's going to jump around unexpectedly. That's why the kids, the young guys like him, can really get the job done here.
And just to put a period of what Matt was talking about on stagger, what that is, that's the difference in size between the left side tires and the right side tires. It don't really change that much with radial tires, but they have about an inch difference that makes the car turn around the corner. And we've seen with this tire configuration where an eighth of an inch difference can make a difference in that car being tighter or looser.
And a guy, again, Larry, people that are back in the pack right now that I think are running their own race, racing the racetrack like we are over and over again, is that guy right there. He knows how to win here. He's not worried right now. Got a good race car. Keep adjusting on it. Be there at the end.
Arnold Palmer was Grand Marshal last week. Did you know that Dale's middle name is Arnold?
I had no idea.
Named
for? After Arnold Palmer.
How about that? Kurt Busch at 98 laps, up on Ryan Newman now by 1.5 seconds. You're watching the battle for the lead as Mach 3 Turbo Champion invites you to enter the Gillette Young Guns Challenge. Each week, a lucky fan will win $5,000 at GilletteYoungGuns.com.
Battle for the lead right here. Ryan Newman in the 12th car goes by Kurt Busch in the 97. This is the longest green run we've had. Look at Casey Kane in the 9. His car's been good on long runs. Now, the real problem, these guys are coming into a lot of lap traffic right in front of them.
Yeah, I think that's affecting what happened right there. I think that Kurt Busch saw the lap traffic, started trying to figure out how to deal with it, and he got passed.
Jeremy Mayfield has a try at Junior. No luck there.
Like I said about Junior's car, it looks fast on the restarts, but it looks like it fades as it goes along to me.
Yeah, he's lost about four positions in about the last four laps.
Another one coming with him. Inside.
Brendan Gaughan has made a pit stop. So has Kevin LePage after slapping the wall. Scott Riggs bounced off the turn two barrier. Needs a pit stop.
Here you see Greg Biffle. We're looking out at Jeremy Mayfield, the 19 car. He's in the seventh, or now the sixth position, looking back at Greg Biffle. It's taken Greg Biffle almost 100 laps to overcome that miscue. I won't call it a miscue, but where they stayed out and everyone else pitted for four tires back on lap 10.
Took Ryan Newman a couple laps there to get past Joe Nemechek in the Army 01. Now Casey Kane has a try. As this track, it's just about barely wide enough for two wide racing, Daryl.
It just kind of tempts you. You know, it makes you want to go places where you know you shouldn't, but you got to go, man. You got to go.
And just to show you how much fresh tires mean, I don't mean to tell you that Kevin LePage in the 4 car does not have a good race car, but what he has right now is 4 fresh tires. Look how he can just drive by the man that's running in second right now, Casey Kane in the 9.
Bobby Labonte battling Ward Burton. And this will be back at 10th place. Steve Burns.
And Mike, Bobby Labonte is saying the nose on this race car is sliding. He said it's loose and tight, and it won't do the same thing two laps in a row. But despite that, he's made his way up slowly but surely at a racetrack where he has one win.
Boy, you know, we heard him saying the same thing last week at Atlanta, Larry. They couldn't get the car to handle. He's Mr. Atlanta. The nose is sliding. I'm loose. And here he is again today. Seems like he's fighting that same problem.
Larry, Scott Riggs is going to get the pit stop he needs after a couple of bounces off the wall.
Yeah, I mean, he was needing to get the pit road. And you can see where a lot of damage on that right side. And they put 4 fresh tires on him. And just remember, we had talked earlier in the day that his jack man, Brian Perry, his father passed away on Monday. They buried his father, Norman Perry, yesterday. Brian got on an airplane and made his way here to do his job the day after he buried his dad.
Boy, that's dedication. Riggs will rejoin the race that Ryan Newman leads over Casey Kane by 0.4 seconds. Kurt Busch in third, Jamie McMurray, Elliott Sadler, Jeremy Mayfield, Greg Biffle.
Now it looks like right now the first to commit to pit road of our leaders for four fresh tires will be Jamie McMurray in the 42 car. He comes to pit road. Now what happens here, Darrell, is you're kind of in a zone here now where you want to, you know, a leader has come to pit road. You're staying out there hoping you get a caution, but you know you can't give up too many laps to those four fresh tires.
Yeah, well, this is when you start watching the stopwatch and Matt, here he comes, buddy.
10 away. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Stop on the board.
And Jamie McMurray felt like he had a tire going down. He had climbed all the way up to fourth. A great run going. Remember, he finished fourth here in the fall race. Had trouble on the second run back in the spring. Was caught up in someone else's mess. Had a lot of damage. 14.3 seconds for McMurray. His car was tight earlier in the race and had worked back to the loose side.
Left of your screen, last year's winner, Ricky Craven. Going to go a lap down to Ryan Newman.
Well, you never want to go a lap down, but don't count anybody out yet. Nope. Long way to go, and anything can happen.
Craven right now is back in the 29th position. Of course, he wants to do everything he can do to possibly stay on the lead lap. And I think what will Ricky Craven, that group, will do, Darrell, once they go a lap down, I think they'll be one of the cars you see come to pit road for four tires. As also Tony Stewart, the 20 car, another one of our top 10 cars. Again, this is a cycle of green flag pit stops that started about two laps ago with Jamie McMurray.
I think we'll see Junior on pit road pretty soon, Larry. He's been really sliding back through the field here the last several laps. I think he needs some adjustment in tires.
Tony Stewart in for a scheduled stop, Steve.
And Mike, he has dropped steadily since the last pit stop. He told his crew that this car is starting to feel like it did at Rockingham. That's the only finish he has had out of the top seven as they're on the left side of that race car. It has been a handful, was his quote.
Kevin Harvick will give up 22nd place to make his pit stop as Stewart comes out after a 15-second stop, and Ryan Newman keeps picking him up and putting him down. 0.4 up on Casey Kane. Matt?
And DW, you were commenting on Dale Earnhardt Jr. fading at a very rapid pace. Junior says the car is real, and I emphasize real loose, especially in center. He says no grip in the back or even the front. In fact, he says, I have bounced off the wall twice. When are we going to pit? You're going to see a lot of guys like the 9 pit around lap 120 to 125. Junior would love to hit pit road now.
But just look at that 42 car right there, Matt. Remember, he was on pit road about four laps ago. He just ran a 31.10, and right now the leaders are running 33 flat. What Jamie McMurray, though, Donnie Wingo, that crew chief, they needed to cycle through these green flag stops, Mike, because he's two laps down right now.
Harvick has finished his stop. He's gone as Elliott Sadler comes in. Sadler was a top five car for quite a while during this run. You see Tony Stewart on fresh tires, rocketing past the rocket man, Ryan Newman.
Yeah, he put a Linda Ronstadt on him.
Blew by you.
That's right.
But he's still one lap down. That made up one of the laps.
Matt?
Todd Parrott tried to fix that 38 car in the last stop with a track bar adjustment and air pressure to help the grip. Elliott said the car was getting better, but like a lot of guys today, late in this run, we're hearing the words loose. And that's what Elliott was saying about that 38 car. As Rodney Fetters, the Jagman, pulls a tear off that windshield to help the visibility for Elliott. 14.4 seconds.
Mark Martin and Scott Wimmer will come to pit road this lap. They'll be joined by Jeremy Mayfield as green flag pit stops continue at lap 117.
Now, what I don't want to do, Larry, is don't bring me into my pits when the guy in front of me or in behind me is in. It's time it where I come in by myself, please.
No, you definitely want to talk to your neighbor and make sure you don't pit on top of each other. Once again, we see Mayfield in for a routine stop, Dick Berger.
And they got the wrench in both sides of the back end of that car. He has been passing cars on the racetrack, Jeremy Mayfield has, but they think they can adjust it for still more speed. Mayfield, all done, he's gone.
Derek Cope and Casey Mears come to pit road, and Greg Biffle is in. These are scheduled green flag stops.
And Greg Biffle in the 16, he has made his way up to the top four, but he comes to pit road for his four fresh tires.
Here comes Junebug, eight car pit road.
There's Culp pulling in bottom of your screen as Mayfield goes past and mirrors. Steve.
And Mike, Greg Biffle running in the top five says his car's a little bit tight. They just made a chassis adjustment. Mike Hillman and Adam Emmer changing tires. Good stop for Greg Biffle. Matt.
And Dale Earnhardt Jr. comes in for his pit stop. Kevin Pinnell, the jack man, jacks it up on the right side. You can see the wrench in the back window, significant wedge adjustment. Dale Jr. said the car was really loose. One comment he made to his crew chief, Tony Urie Sr., he said, I might have messed up something in the rear end of the car when he hit the wall a couple different times. To Dick Berger.
Jimmy Johnson is in as well. He had been losing position. He said it just wouldn't stick upstairs, and the car was right everywhere. They have adjusted for that. He's gone, too.
Jeff Burton is in along with Rusty Wallace as green flag stops continue, and Dale Jarrett hits pit road.
Rusty Wallace in the two car, he found out just about how hard you can come on the pit road. He almost didn't make it. Daryl, he finally did make it to pit road down there in one of your hot spots.
Yeah, he just about turned that bad boy around.
Kenny Schrader, Jeff Green, Terry Labonte all on pit road as well as you watch Rusty stop.
And you know, Larry, we always come to Darlington or Bristol, two of our racetracks, where we did special things to our car to keep the tires off of the fenders, the fenders off the tires, knowing that we're going to bang into the wall or bang into somebody.
Kyle Petty in along with Robbie Gordon.
Our points leader, Matt Kenseth, the 17 car, comes to pit road. All these are routine
here, come
stops.
On, come on, call. 3, 2, there you go.
Dick?
Way down the other end of pit road, Mike. Can't see him.
Robbie Gordon's going to get four. Pitted toward the outside edge of the pit box. The team comes around the left side. Bobby Labonte coming in along with Joe Nemechek and Ward Burton. Point leader, Matt Kenseth. On the lower right of your screen, now full screen, as Robbie Reiser's Killer Bees go to work.
Most of these stops, it's not because these cars needed fuel, it's because their drivers were screaming, I need tires, I need this race car adjusted on. Johnny Sauter in the 30 car, he's on pit road as we watch Bobby Labonte in 18 car, his pit stop, Steve Burns.
Bobby Labonte's crew going to work. Believe it or not, Larry Mack, as much of a handful as this car has been, they're not going to make any major chassis adjustments to the 18. Also, his stop, a good break for Ryan Newman when he stops, because Newman will now have a clear shot out of his pit.
Johnny Sauter in along with the third place car of Kurt Busch and Sterling Marlin.
Sterling had to work his way in the top five.
You give me four of them Mr. Feelgoods and I'll stop whining for a little while.
Hit Ryan Newman, almost spun out, and what it did in the 12 car, it made Casey Kane miss pit road. That's his first green flag stop at Darlington, though. In a Nextel Cup car, you have to go through that learning experience.
Missed the commit line, I believe. That cone is down. I'm not sure if Newman got it or who did.
The track bar adjustment already completed for Kurt Busch as he's down and away.
And I think Ryan Newman made the commit line, Steve Burns.
Larry Mack, they just took the wedge wrench out of the left rear side of that car for Ryan Newman. Four tires and a small air pressure adjustment. He's away. Clean shot out for him.
Ricky Rudd and Brian Vickers are in. Let's show you what happened as Ryan Newman's number 12 tried to come to pit road.
Well, we talked about this earlier in the hot spots. You know, this is one of those places where you get in big trouble here, even when you're slowing down, trying to get into the pits. And he almost backed it into the tire barrier down, or the barrels down there.
Boy, that's close. Let's show you what Casey Kane saw. And you see that Newman takes out the cone, which means he did not make it through the commit line between the cones. He will get a drive-through penalty. Matt.
The Dodge boys going to work. Steve Lawrence just put the track bar wrench in the back window. Adjustment completed. We told you earlier, the last two runs, Casey Kane's been complaining the car is just way too free. Krushak and Pullman done. Good stop by the nine guys.
Now, this was explained at the drivers' meeting in Atlanta. David Hoot said in response to a question, he said, you must pass between the cones, and a driver raised his hand and asked, well, what if you knock down the cones? And Hoots repeated, you must pass between the cones. Newman did not.
And he is receiving the black flag right now at the start-finish line from the flagman. And a pass-through means he don't have to stop in his pits. Of course, Ryan Newman's wanting to know why are they displaying the black flag at me.
Pass-through pit road speed.
But what he has to do is come down pit road, maintain 45 miles per hour. He does not have to stop in his pits.
And what happened with Casey Kane was he wasn't sure where Ryan was going to end up. So he had to abort and go around because he thought Ryan was possibly going to hit those barrels and bounce out into him.
Good move by Casey Kane. Now, Newman got the nose down under the cone. He may not even be aware that he hit it with the rear of the car.
And right now, our leader, Jamie McMurray, in the 42 car, is coming off turn four. Remember, he got those fresh tires earlier than anyone, so Ryan Newman will go a lap down right here on pit road on his pass-through. He's going to be about a lap and a half down. But what I noticed about Casey Kane, the second time coming to pit road, he was almost too timid, Darrell. He got down off the racetrack in turn three, and that will cost him a lot of time.
I'd rather have him wet that way, Larry, than I had to try to make it all up and mess up again. So you made one mistake, don't make two.
Ryan Newman comes back up to speed as Matt Borland, his crew chief, looks on, and Jamie McMurray is the new leader in Darlington.
Welcome back to Darlington. This is a Visa race break. Jamie McMurray currently leading here in Darlington as we've gone through 134 laps. Let's go back a little bit earlier. Michael Waltrip, who's had a rough start to the season so far on the ninth lap, into the wall, out of the race. He has since come back into the race, but facing another back-of-the-pack finish. And then Andy Hillenburg in the way of Tony Stewart. And then Jeff Gordon runs into Hillenburg. Hillenburg apologizing for the slow car. Gordon saying, hey, maybe too many filler cars in the field that don't belong. And Ryan Newman, for the second time today, taking the lead in his Dodge. But then moments ago, trying to pit, hits the cone, is penalized for that, and loses the lead. And Jeff Hammond, a quick look at the pit summary. Obviously, the big loser there was Ryan Newman.
Yeah, you can see right there, Jamie McMurray was the benefactor of the fact he thought he had a flat tire, basically short pitted, came in 20th, and now he's leading the race. Greg Biffle and his guys have been struggling all day to get back up to the lead after not pitting early on, but now he's got himself back up to second position, and things are looking pretty good for him.
Made McDonald's drive-through championship back again this season. We've been telling you about that. The participating pitcher with the fastest cumulative pit time will win a weekly prize of $20,000. The crew with the fastest through the whole season, the entire season, will win $200,000. Jamie McMurray currently leading Greg Biffle and Jeremy Mayfield, the Everham Dodge. We had Casey Kane up around the lead for the while. He's hanging in there as well after his second place finish last week.
But look at this right now, Chris. One of the guys I really kind of like is kind of sneaking up in there is Bobby Labonte. They've been working on his car very diligently. We're taking a look right now at the leader, Jimmy McMurray. But a lot of guys say, you think this 42 car is going to be good here today, but I like what I'm seeing right now from the number five guy, Bobby Labonte.
And there is Bobby Labonte, who had, as Darrell had pointed out, problems with the nose, or at least the front end of the car. Maybe they've corrected those problems.
Right now, I believe they have. I know Fatback Swain was not very happy with that. He's the crew chief on that car early today. They made some changes, been working very hard on it. He's looking really good. And another guy back here is running pretty good today. We're looking from his in-car camera is Robbie Gordon. He has started way back in the pack today, but he's been diligently working his way up through there. And Chris, he's one of those guys who got a benefit of running the Busch race on Saturday.
And Robbie Gordon, saw him earlier today, did have success in the Busch race. And as you said, currently running 10th. Let's go back to the leader, Jamie McMurray, for a moment, because he was with us in the Hollywood Hotel and got to watch the Busch race from here, and also talked a lot about handling the wall with the limited space and the comfort level he had with that.
Well, I think right now what has happened here is that what he's been able to do is adjust himself and realize you cannot overdrive these corners. Very smart driver. He's got a very good crew chief in Donnie Wingo. I think he's really coaching this guy. And here's a guy right now starting to slip back through the field, and that's Dale Earnhardt Jr. I don't know what happened. They've lost a handle on this race car.
The junior down to 17th now, Sterling Marlin, right around where he is, maybe possibly in position to pass Dale Earnhardt Jr., who came into this race third in points. Of course, Matt Kenseth, your points leader, hoping to stay in the hunt as well. Let's go back upstairs, rejoin Darrell, Larry, and Mike.
One fellow whose day is looking a lot better is Greg Biffles. He won yesterday, made an early strategy call, a decision early on in this race that put him way, way back in the field. But Larry, second place now.
They have overcome it. It took them over 100 laps to overcome it after that great qualifying run. But now here at lap 140, he's up there running in second place. And I've been watching the lap times. Other than when he's working traffic, he's pretty good. I mean, he's as good as anybody right now.
And Steve Burns is with Greg Biffle's crew chief.
Well, Doug, on lap 8, when you guys decided to stay out, I heard you say, uh-oh, but you have patiently stayed with your game plan.
Well, it was a costly mistake. We were sitting there talking on the radio and missed the opportunity to win. But we had a really good run there right before that last green flag stop. And the car was really good, so we were able to gain a lot of track position. The car's still pretty good, just a little bit too loose right now. But so far, it's a good day for the Travel Lodge Ford.
I tell you what, guys, his teammate, Mark Martin, in that six car qualified back in 20th position. Now, Mark, a lot like Jamie McMurray, as he's up there battling Elliott Sadler for the eighth position, he was one of the guys that came to pit road early and got those four fresh tires, and it made up a lot of track position. But Mark, just remember, after Daytona, he was 43rd in points, finished dead last after he lost that engine. We got Jamie McMurray. He just put a lap on Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the 8 car. Matt, it didn't take long for that car to get lapped.
It sure did. Let's check in with the car chief, Tony Urie Jr. What is your cousin saying about his car now, Tony?
Before, we were real loose in the center of the corner, which we want to be here at the end of a race, but kind of battling like it's on a knife edge because we've done a little bike there, and now we're way too tight. Can't do nothing about it. So hopefully we can just hold on to something here and make something happen.
We've got a caution on the racetrack.
The 9 car, Casey Kane, I believe he's got a tire that's down, and the caution is out. He's very lucky he didn't hit that wall hard, Darrell.
I don't think he hit it at all, and I don't think he's going to lose a lap.
Caution is out. This will be the fourth one of the day for Casey Kane. Comes out at lap 145.
Of course, he may have already been a lap down from that miscue going into the pits.
And guess who gets the free pass? Dale Jr., who just went a lap down. Because the field freezes at the moment of caution, first car a lap down gets the pass. Let's look again to see what happened to Casey Kane.
Yeah, you see the
look like the right rear tire possibly just coming off turn 4.
Kind of looks like what I saw that car do at Homestead last fall
with Bill Elliott in it as he was leading the race on a white flag lap.
Now this is what I'm talking about right here. This is where these young guys like him, he's got great car control, good hand-eye coordination, and he doesn't give up on that thing and he keeps it off the wall. You see him, he's wiggling off the turn there, off of turn 4. And then the tire goes.
Pole sitter Casey Kane brings out the race's fourth caution. You're watching NASCAR on Fox.
Pit stops. Jeremy Mayfield pits out of fourth position. The car has been a top 10 car all day long. Pit stops have been flawless all day long. The car is a little bit loose. They're going to add a little bit of weight in the left rear to Steve Burns.
Greg Biffle just a little free, Dick. They're going to make a track bar adjustment, which they just did, and a half a pound of air on the left side. Back.
Gas man Mike Bodick already made a wedge adjustment for Jimmy McMurray's Dodge. He said it was just barely free, so Donnie Wingo called for a slight adjustment. And let's backtrack to lap 109 when he thought he had a flat tire. The tire was fine, but short pitting actually helped him against the competition.
It helped a lot of guys, Matt. It helped Jamie McMurray. It helped Mark Martin as well as we get the halfway signal. This race is halfway over.
Kind of feels like 500 miles already.
Well, it really does. And I tell you, Dale Jr. in the 8 car was really, really, that's a lucky break for him, because Schrader, who was right behind Dale Jr., was sitting there ready to get that lap back. And Schrader's been running pretty darn good, but Jr. just got past when the caution came out.
And almost got caught up in it. Watch the 9. You see that Jr. is past Casey Kane before Kane is in trouble. So Kane could not have been the free pass car. NASCAR NASCAR Nextel Cup Racing on Fox is brought to you by Budweiser. It's time for a fresh one. Grab a Budweiser. The race is on. Welcome back to Darlington, South Carolina. We're just finishing up the fourth caution of the day for Casey Kane's flat tire, as you'll hear Dale Earnhardt Jr. before the pit stop talk strategy with Tony Urey Jr.
You'll be the lucky dog there.
I'll be that lucky dog. Hey, Junior, let's go all the way back to where we started, man, because we just keep tightening it up, getting in, and trying, and through the middle, trying to turn down off of two. And it's just real, real pushing getting into turn one. And it seems like we just keep hurting, making that worse and worse.
What it sounds like is, and he was talking to Tony Urey Jr., which is the car chief on that car, is they've been trying to fix that car in one place, probably from the center off. They've really not been fixing that, but they've been hurting it getting in the corner. So let's just go back to where we started when we were so good. But I do think the racetrack is different from then.
Jimmy Johnson, 6th to 4th on his pit stop.
Get ready.
Speed and across the stripe, 17 cars on the lead lap. Pole sitter Casey Kane, who brought out that caution, one of the cars one lap down.
Don't take them long to get up to speed with that 800 horsepower. Start off at 55 miles per hour, going off into one and two at well over 150 miles an hour.
There are 15 cars one lap down. That round of green flag pit stops pretty much split the field in half.
And there's nothing any better when they tell you you're going to get a lap back. That gives you, I tell you, it changes your attitude. And you heard how calm Junior was. If he'd have been a lap down, he wouldn't have been that calm.
Critics have debated the free pass rule. NASCAR instituted it when they eliminated racing back to the caution flag. They accepted the premise that at least one driver might have had a chance to race the leader back and get back on the lead lap. So they legislated, made it a rule. It's had defenders and detractors, but so far it's worked pretty well.
Yeah, I don't really like it, but I don't really have a problem with it anymore. It's like everything we do, once we get racing, it is what it is, and you just go on.
Settle in, buddy. Got a little bit of breathing room here.
Now, they're coming up on lapped cars that are battling hard. Kevin Harvick there with Ryan Newman, who had to serve a penalty and go one lap down for knocking over the commitment cones at the entrance to pit road.
And what you heard Jimmy Johnson spotted in the 48 car as it told him as he went down the backstretch as he goes by Greg Biffle here in the 16 car. That is the battle for third. Is you always want to know, Darrell, I think, as a driver here, what's behind me? He told him, you've got a little bit of breathing room behind you, so you can search around just a little bit.
Yeah, because you can run a lot of different lines here. You can try to lower and you can get right up there next to the wall, and if you got, you know, somebody breathing down your back, then you got to worry about them getting under you and wrecking you.
You're riding with Casey Kane, who was the pole sitter but cut down that tire, now finds himself 31st at the tail end of the car's one lap down. Matt,
his crew chief, a two-time winner here at Darlington. Tommy, is the car okay?
That seems to be it. We must have got a flat as soon as we left pit road coming into that last stop there, and this car was way off from the beginning there, so we got a four fresh Goodyears on, no problem with the Dodge car. We'll hopefully get our lap back and go racing.
Restarted 32nd, one lap down. Fact, Mike, Casey Kane came on the radio and said, please, you guys talk to me. I heard a lot of silence. The more you talk to me, the better. His spotter, Michael Landis, sounds more like an air traffic controller trying to work him through the traffic.
All right, now Steve, how about Greg Biffle? Because Biffle overcame a strategy miscue, got himself back up as high as second place. But Steve, does he have a problem?
Oh, Mike, he thinks he's got a flat tire. They're trying to decide what to do right now. It is confirmed he does have a flat tire. And when they come, if they come in, or when they come in, rather, they might just change two tires and get back out so they lose less time.
I don't know, DW. I believe I'm going to come to pit road, even under green. I'm going to go ahead while I'm there. I'm going to get me four tires, because you've already wore the left sides out at this place as much as the right sides.
But he obviously doesn't have a flat tire. He's got something going on here, you know, like maybe he thinks he's got a tire going down. But he's running awfully well to have a tire problem at this point.
Look at that green car, Darrell. The fellow who dominated this track for many years, David Pearson, who leads all drivers with 10 victories. He'd lead a lot of laps, but sometimes he'd just kind of sneak up on you. Bobby Labonte is doing that today. Currently finds himself in fifth.
Yeah, I really am impressed with the job that the Fatback and the boys have done to get him in back in the hunt, because he was really complaining about that car halfway through the race.
I tell you who else I'm impressed with is that orange car back there, Robbie Gordon in that 31. Qualified back in 29th. I talked to his crew chief, Chris Andrews, this morning. Said, Larry, we've had good race cars. We just have no luck. I mean, in four races this year, they've had two DNFs, and they came in here 32nd in points. But he's backing up what he told me this morning.
Yeah, unlike a lot of guys I watch, he's kind of timid here. Robbie's not timid.
And he did run the Busch race yesterday.
Steve has an update on fourth place Greg Biffle.
Well, Mike, Greg Biffle thought for sure that he had a tire going down. Now he thinks it's a brake rotor on the right front. A brake rotor. They're trying to hang on to see exactly what it is.
And I think what sometimes will happen, Darrell, maybe you'll warp a brake rotor, and it'll vibrate, almost makes you think you've got a flat tire.
Yeah, you don't use a lot of brake here. And what you do when you use them real hard, real fast, and you'll get
turn two, Matt Kenseth goes around. Didn't see how that started, but
caution is out.
Oh, more cars.
Ricky Craven in the 32.
Scott Riggs. And now everybody woes up on the brakes and we'll get through. But Craven's car looks pretty well done.
He had got us in the back.
Yep, Riggs got into Craven, but Kenseth will drive away.
I think Kenseth spun, the 10 slowed down, and 32 slowed down, the 10 got into him.
Now, I'm quite sure saying Matt Kenseth, the 17 car, as we watch Scott Riggs with a lot of damage. But Matt Kenseth, our points leader, will stay on the lead lap, I'm almost sure.
I don't know, Larry. He's creeping along down the back. I think he's trying to keep from tires from tearing up the body on the car.
Left side looks pretty well torn up already.
But he has a flat left rear tire, is exactly what Darrell's saying.
That bad boy comes apart, it'll rip the body off that thing.
Let's see what happened here at lap 161 from Ricky Rudd.
Oh, he just got in there on the flat, and that'll loosen you up sometime a little bit. He must have already been a little free, and the car just came around with him.
So he's down on the apron. Looks like, no, he's not coming back up.
But you know what? He's got a right front tire that looks like, of course, I know he spun, but you don't usually have flat spot tires too bad here. He may have had a tire problem.
All right, guys, he's on pit road right now, and what they did, smart move by Robbie Reiser in that group. He was close to going a lap down, so they just changed the left side tires now. He'll go around, get caught back up, then come get those fresh right sides.
But that right one is flat, too. You don't want that thing to come apart.
Ricky Craven, last year's winner by 3 inches. This year, gets run into. Ricky's okay. You see the Hans device, the head and neck support, still on his shoulders as he gets the helmet off.
And I'm pretty sure our pardon goes to Ryan Newman in the 12 car. So he will be back on the lead lap. A lot of damage on Casey Mears in the 41 car. Great run at Atlanta last week. Had that engine expire on him. Great run at Las Vegas.
Pit road is closed. Several cars there damaged, being worked on, including Brian Vickers and Scott Riggs. We're under yellow at Darlington. NASCAR Nextel Cup Racing on Fox is brought to you by Ford, the official truck of NASCAR. By the new 4-for-all pizza. Everyone gets the toppings they want, only at Pizza Hut. By Nextel, coast-to-coast walkie-talkies in under a second. NASCAR and Nextel, partners in speed. And by New Levitra, new choice, here now. Ask your doctor today. Caution out for Matt Kenseth's spin in turn two, which caught up Ricky Rudd, Scott Riggs, and Ricky Craven. Craven's car has been hauled back to the garage. The others are on pit road under repair. They're going to open pit road this time by for lead lap cars. And there are the front five on your screen at 164 laps.
Now, Matt Kenseth did stay on the lead lap because he pitted before pit road was open. When we restart this race, he'll have to start at the tail end of the lead lap of the longest line.
Dick Bergman.
Jimmy Johnson has had great pit stops all day. Tire changes, Corey Quick and Joe Zanellini have been right on their game. Every single stop has been in the 13-second bracket, and just as he came in this time, crew chief Chad Knaus said, no home runs, make it smooth. Steve.
This caution is a big break for Greg Biffle running in the top four. They thought they had a flat tire, then perhaps a brake rotor problem. They will change all four tires and make air pressure adjustments. Big break for Greg Biffle. Matt.
Steve, a great run going for the second straight trip to Darlington for Jimmy McMurray. He said the car, after that wedge adjustment, had gone from loose to just a tick on the tight side, but he didn't want to make any adjustments to the 42 car.
Kurt Busch pulls out after making his stop. He's been a contender all day long. And let's add Brian Vickers and Casey Mears to the cars involved in the accident at turn two. The first caution of the day was Michael Waltrip back at lap number nine. He was the first driver in this race to test the new safer barrier as he lost a left rear tire entering turn number three and slid up into the fence. He is back in the race after repairing damage. A year ago, that car might have had to go to the garage for the day. Here's Dick Berggren with today's WebMD safety report.
For this race, for the first time, the new safer barrier is installed at all four turns here at Darlington Raceway. The barrier is 30 inches wide. Its construction, 10 sheets of impact-absorbing foam, and then square steel tubing. Now, the drivers always ran right up against the fence, but now they've got the fence 30 inches closer to them. So guess what? Bam, a blue car. Bam, a red car. And some black tire mark as well. One of the things that's happened here as a result of the new safer barrier is that the groove has narrowed up. Look, there's hardly room for two cars to sit side by side on this turn, even if they're not moving. But at 170 miles an hour, this is the limit, because right down here, the track flattens out. The groove has gotten a whole lot more narrow, and as a result, bouncing up into that wall is a whole lot easier.
For information on how to keep your family safe and healthy, visit webmd.com. Now, we talked about Matt Kenseth pitting before the pit lane was open. You are allowed to do that. However, you are not allowed to pass cars under caution and pull up to the safety car to make that pit stop. And that is what's being discussed right now. NASCAR is saying that Kenseth pulled up in line to pit, and they want to pull him in and hold him a lap for that.
Not getting my dog in that fight? I don't know. I can't really say for sure about that.
But guys, real quick, I'm going to tell you what. Two crews that really shined on that pit stop. Jeff Hammond's been talking about it. Jimmy Johnson in that 48 car in that first pit box. He got in, got his work done. He won the battle off pit road, and there you see it. His guys know it. But another crew that really shined, Robbie Gordon's Chris Andrews-led crew, they're going to come out in third position. Good pit stop for that group.
Yeah. Actually, giving you the black flag, the 17. They don't black flag many cars. Hey, you know what? Bergman's down there, and he's talking about the soft walls and all that stuff. This track has gone through incredible changes over the last several years. Front straightaway to the back and so forth, single pit lane. This is the 101st race here. And that means this joint has a history. And what you can learn is this average 13 cars normally finish on the lead lap here. And there's usually 5 to 9 cautions during the races here. So that's a bit of history that the crews and the crew chiefs can use to help them determine how they're going to run their race.
They're going to black flag Matt Kenseth, hold him one lap for pulling up to pit. That's the decision of the NASCAR officials. We'll be right back.
Now playing at IMAX Theaters.
NASCAR Nextel Cup Racing on Fox is brought to you by Quaker State, the power to reduce friction. Green flag is just back out, and Jimmy Johnson will haul them around Darlington Raceway. Kurt Busch, Robbie Gordon, Greg Biffle, Mark Martin. The first five, Bobby Labonte, Jeremy Mayfield, Jamie McMurray, Two-time winner here, Ward Burton and Dale Jarrett are the top 10. There are 17 cars on the lead lap, including Ryan Newman, who got the free pass.
God, Dale Jarrett just keeps creeping into the picture. I've noticed him slowly getting there.
Look, the 17, Matt Kenseth, he has a tire rub. Steve Burns, he's got all kinds of troubles.
Yes, he does, Larry McReynolds. And before he spun, he told crew chief Robbie Reiser that he was concerned about tire pressures, and then they, in fact, had a flat tire. When they came down pit road to serve their penalty, Matt said, make sure you look at this body. Make sure there's nothing rubbing. There's a lot of anger down here in the pits about this penalty.
A little on the backstretch, too, as Ward Burton and Rusty Wallace got together exiting turn number two.
Yeah, Rusty got a piece of the wall. He got up on the outside. Ward got under him and knocked him up in the fence.
They were battling for eighth position. But, yeah, right now, Matt Kenseth is a lap and a half down, basically in 30th position.
Let's show you this again. As they exited turn two, DW's hot spot.
There you go, and Ward just gets into him. Come on, Ward. There you go. Smoke him a little. Good job, Rusty. He had to back out of the throttle. Lost a lot of momentum, but he didn't hit the wall. The lady in black survived one more time.
Of course, the two things that could happen to you there is get a fender on a tire or cut a valve stem.
Yeah, more. You know, that's the kind of rub that we've seen cut tires down this year.
Doesn't matter if it's concrete or a safer barrier, Darrell. You get into the wall here, the wall wins.
Oh, yeah. I fought the wall, and the wall always wins, I'm telling you.
Working lap 174, Matt Kenseth served his penalty, spent a lap on pit road, the last lap of that caution, and came out tail end of the field. A lap down. There's Kenseth.
Oh, and he's going, you know, this is reminiscent of what he did at Atlanta. Remember, he spun coming on pit road, and he went a lap down. And then he drove like a wild man to get back to be the first car a lap down. And I think that's what he's trying to do now.
That's
a little
fender,
more difficult here.
That fender may be bent from the contact with Ricky Rudd after Kenseth spun down to the apron at turn two.
I think it's going to be okay, though. Those pressures will come up in the tires. We see that occasionally on restarts. I don't think that's going to be the big problem. I don't think that's his biggest problem right now. Getting back on the lead lap is what his problem is.
I tell you what, we've been watching him since this race started. Mark Martin in that six car, we talked about the young guns, talked about the veterans. We have two of them running together. Mark Martin in the six, he's in fifth position. And right behind him, Bobby Labonte in that 18 car, he's in six.
And you knew that Mark was going to be good, Larry, because he was the fastest car here in happy hour. And I watched his car. It's very fast, very comfortable looking.
Now for more on Bobby Labonte, here's Steve.
Remember a while ago I said even though Bobby Labonte had said that his car was loose and tight at opposite ends of the racetrack, that Fatback McSwain didn't make any changes. The reason is the track temperature has dropped 10 degrees since the start of this race, and they feel like the track is coming to them. Let's go to Dick.
David has made it back to the garage and looked at what is left of his race car. A hard, hard hit in the right front corner. What happened?
Well, I just got run over. The caution came out. I think Matt spun down in one and two. The amazing thing was three or four or 5 seconds went by and I got run over. And it's inexcusable, you know. There are some things you can accept, but that was stupidity.
Who ran you over?
I believe it was the 10 car. And I just can't believe in a day where you don't race back to the yellow, when the caution comes out, you have nothing to gain, you get run over. I mean, the guy has got to just think about what he's doing. I don't understand it.
Last year's winner wrecked in the garage, Mike.
And that's the thing. The point I was going to make is when the yellow comes out, stop. There's no racing. The field is frozen. There's no reason to keep pushing it.
Only reason I can think of to keep your foot in it some is to keep yourself from getting run over. But once that settles out, slow down.
I think it's instinctive, though, that when the yellow first comes out, the guys still haven't gotten it. They still don't realize if I just slow down, nobody can pass me. I'm not going to lose anything.
Guys, we're watching Dale Earnhardt Jr.
Dale Jarrett in the wall in turn three.
Oh. And he's a bunch of cars going underneath him right there.
He got in it pretty good, Larry.
Yeah, because he's got a bad tire rub, and he was running up in the top 10 when that happened. He'd been coming all day long. He'll definitely have to get to pit road. The biggest problem is getting down where he can get the pit road.
Yeah, he looks like he's shredded that left rear. And he's trying to get down to the bottom of the racetrack. When you hit the wall in turn four, it's a long way to go around to get back to pit road.
My rear, Mike, let's pull it out.
Yeah, he's definitely got a flat tire. The racetrack's clear now. Just he's got to be careful trying to get back around. He's going to lose a couple laps before he even gets to pit road. He just felt like this was going to be a Dale Jarrett kind of a day.
Yeah, we just talked about how he moved up and how good his car looked, and the old lady gets him.
Well, you said the top of the day, Darrell, this race would go to the driver who and team who made the least mistakes, and I guess we should have added, and who has the best luck.
You got to have a lot of luck here, buddy, and you can't go to the luck bank too much here or you get overdrawn.
Yeah, he's hit that thing so hard it looks like it's knocked a rear end over, probably been a trailing arm or the track bar or something. Bad.
Kurt Busch closed to within about a tenth of leader Jimmy Johnson. Now it's stretched back out to 0.3 seconds on that last stop. His crew chief, Jimmy Findig, made zero changes. They feel like the racetrack, as the temperature starts to come down, like Steve Burns mentioned earlier, that the track is going to start to tighten up, and they didn't get a long enough run, so they didn't want to make any changes to over-adjust that race car and dial themselves out to Steve Burns.
Matt, big disappointment for Dale Jarrett, a guy who has won here three times in the spring. He's got a shredded tire that came off the right rear. He had made very, very small adjustments throughout the course of this race. A big disappointment for Dale Jarrett.
Jarrett's going to be at least two laps down as he re-enters the race. Jimmy Johnson is our ninth different leader today. None of those nine are among the 40 drivers who have driven into victory lane at NASCAR's toughest track.
You know, and our guys are talking about the track temperature coming down. I don't think the weather has changed that much, but I've been watching these flags outside our booth. I mean, the wind is blowing so hard, I think that's cool to track down. Plus, over in turn four, where they run in the groove, we've seen a shadow start to come there. But you look right there, just remember, we were about 111 degrees down in turn three and four, and 86 degrees in one and two, and we do have caution for debris.
That may have been from Dale Jarrett's tire. It's down in turn one. And that puts us under caution for the sixth time today.
And I do believe the 29 car, Kevin Harvick, who has really struggled today, he will be the beneficiary. He will get the pardon from the Oval Office.
That's a big break for Kansas now, because he's got a good race car.
Well, it's not tire.
Not sure what that is.
Let's have a look at it. What brings out this caution for the sixth time today? Oh, that. Whatever hit our camera in turn number one. Jimmy Johnson leads in the Carolina Dodge Dealers 400. NASCAR Nextel Cup Racing on Fox is brought to you by Napa Auto Parts. Napa, get the good stuff. By Wendy's new spinach chicken salad. It's better here. And by Aaron's Sales and Lease Ownership. Let Aaron's drive your dreams home today. Caution flag pit stops just concluded. We're under the sixth yellow of the day for a piece of metal debris down in turn number one.
I tell you, we got a lot of great racing on the racetrack, but I want to tell you, the racing on pit road and the race off pit road is phenomenal.
Jimmy Johnson, top of your screen. He's pitted way up at the turn four end of pit road. He'll probably be done before everybody else is in their pit.
Yeah, and first pit box in. And here's the deal. As the field thins out, there's less and less cars for him to have to wait on. So he can get out of there, and there's not many people in his way going down pit road.
Greg Biffle getting his stop finished up. Jimmy Johnson is on the way down pit road as Kurt Busch comes to a halt. Biffle pulls out. Kurt Busch is going to get a good stop from his team, and he's going to scoot out just about the time Jimmy gets there. And they drag race to the end line. Look at that. How close can you get?
That's as close as it gets off pit road.
So we're under caution at lap 187 out of 293. She was. before pictures. Hats off to the Fox Music Department. You heard Shattered as we showed you the replay from our Turn 1 camera. This is, of course, AWB picking up the pieces. Annie Lennox must be next. You know, walking on broken glass. We pick up the pieces from this. They're picked up and we're ready to go back to green.
See Dale Jarrett in 88, the UPS car, the inside of our leader Jimmy Johnson. Right now he is two laps down right there. Remember, he had to make that green flag pit stop a few laps ago because of the flat tire. He elected to stay out, but right now he is going backwards in a hurry. They're going by him left and right.
Dick Bergeron on leader Jimmy Johnson.
Boy, everything is going just right for Jimmy Johnson, Mike. Crew chief Chad Knaus, after the caution flag flew, told his driver, good job, Hot Rod. And then he called for a whole bunch of changes to be made on that race car. And every single one of those crew members came to the fore, and they did a beautiful pit stop. 12.6 seconds. Usually the rear tire changes the slowest on most pit stops. Joe Zanellini has done a beautiful job. He has been right with them all on every single stop. Great stops today. Matty.
Second 1 year ago, the 97, Kurt Busch currently runs second. He told his crew chief, Jimmy Finning, he said, it feels like I'm actually faster than the 48 of Jimmy Johnson. I just can't pass him with the dirty air. I feel like it's causing me to lose too much of front grip, and then it makes the back end start to slide a little bit. Jimmy tried to fix his race car just a smidgen to try to help Kurt make a run on the 48. Made an air pressure adjustment to Steve Burns.
Hey, Matty, an air pressure adjustment for Greg Biffle as well. He said, I'm just a little tight. They went down a half pound on that right front tire. Now, to go back just a little bit, remember Biffle reported he thought he had a flat tire. They got a break when the caution came out, and the caution prior to the most previous one. They still do not know what was wrong with that tire. Crew chief Doug Richards saying they may have damaged it with air pressures being too low.
Now, Larry, these guys must not be watching the same race we're watching, because every time somebody stays out on there, Dale Jarrett's restarted up on the front row, and he is going back through the field and about to get run over on every corner.
Yeah, I mean, we saw it happen on lap 9 almost 200 laps ago, and yeah, they are not learning. But guys, we've got 100 laps to go. Jimmy Johnson, Robbie Gordon, Bobby Labonte, they just ran the quickest lap that they've run in this race. It's getting right now.
Oh, yeah. Well, the cars are adjusted up. The weather's getting better. Track's cooling down. There's a song in there somewhere.
Or there will be. Jeff Burton, Hot Wheels on that car, a one race deal, and he has some Hot Wheels. He is coming through the field and finds himself at 11th right now.
Yeah, started back in 33rd, but remember, way back early in the race, he got front end damage on pit road, got in the back of Jeremy Mayfield's car. They spent extensive time on pit road on the caution, kept him on the lead lap. His car is so good on green runs. I just know Jeff Burton does not want to see another caution in this race.
Seventeen cars on the lead lap. Right behind Burton, Earnhardt Jr. finds himself 12th ahead of Stewart, Wimmer, Harvick, Marlin, and Burton. Warburton.
Darrell, I still don't believe. I mean, he's back on the lead lap. Remember, he got the pardon a while ago. He's up in 12th position. But watching the lap times, although he ran a pretty quick lap then, I still don't think they've got that car where they want it.
No, but it's better than it was. He has been able to pass some cars, and he's back there running in that high groove again and making some pretty good time here, looks like. It's kind of what they did at Atlanta. I mean, the car to me had the same traits that it had at Atlanta. It went off. It was good on short runs, but at the end of the day, they got it good.
Riding with Mark Martin, the Roush cars right now are second, sixth, 11th.
Looking inside, clear, clear.
Driver Mark Martin knows Darlington. In Busch competition here, he has won 8 races and 8 poles, more than anyone else by a factor of 2. In 36 Nextel Cup starts, Martin and his Ford have earned 14 top fives, 2 poles, 5 second place finishes, and a win. One of Darlington's all-time greats, Ford driver Mark Martin, right now running in 6th. If you haven't looked at a Ford lately, look again. Now Mark's car is not where he wants it right now. Jamie McMurray in the 42 car, he goes by them. This is a battle for 8th position we're watching.
So McMurray picks up the spot, moves him back up in the order to eighth place in that Texaco Dodge. Matt,
just trying to battle back from a miscue on that lap 165 stop when a lug fell off. It cost him eight spots on the racetrack. This last stop, Donnie Wingo backed up half a round, took that wedge out they put in two stops ago. Jamie is now trying to work his way back up. One other note, he told Donnie and spotter Lauren Rear, next time we come back, I want to put that small mirror on the left side window like we run at a lot of other places. I feel like it will actually help me a lot here on restarts.
You never learn what you can do to these race cars to help your driver. It may be something simple as a different rearview mirror. You got to make that note, bring it back different. I tell you, a car that's been there all day long, solidly, Casey Kane's teammate, Jeremy Mayfield, in that 19 car. He's just been good and solid. Has some damage to the rear of the car, but I think it's in a place where it's not affected.
17 cars in the lead lap, another 13 cars, one lap down. The field got split by one round of green flag pit stops. We've had six caution flags. Notable cars out of the race, including Jeff Gordon, who got caught up in a lap 28 crash, and Ricky Craven, who went out in a crash at lap 161.
17 pit road, Mike. I say he's been falling back, and I think he may have a flat tire.
He's back in the 30th position, two laps down. He's going to go three, maybe four laps down on the screen flag stop. Steve Burns.
Loose wheel or broken wheel? It's got to be broken wheel.
And Larry, I'm listening to Matt Kenseth, and he said it's either a loose wheel or a broken wheel as he heads on a pit road right now. Loose wheel or a broken wheel?
Well, you're a lap down. You're out there. You're trying to salvage the best finish you can in the start. You know, you have a problem. I guess you have to come back in because there's no point making a bad day a whole lot worse.
This hole just keeps getting deeper, though.
Have a look at points as of the moment. Kenseth's lead would sink to 31 over Dale Jr. and 34 over Tony Stewart. We're inside 100 laps to go here at the track, too tough to tame as they investigate the wheel that just came off Matt Kenseth's car. NASCAR Nextel Cup Racing on Fox is brought to you by Dodge. You can take life as it comes, or you can grab life by the horns. Dodge.
Fox, glad to have you with us here in Darlington, and the aerial views brought to you by Quaker State Oil. Jimmy Johnson, your leader. We've gone 209 laps. Jimmy Johnson has moved from 25th to ninth in the points race over the last couple of races, trying to hang on here. And with Matt Kenseth, the points leader, having trouble with his wheel, this could be a big move. And you actually spoke to Chad Knaus about Jimmy Johnson.
Yeah, he told me earlier today, Chris, he said one thing I really like about this particular driver, he says he knows how to figure out his competition, figure out how to pass him, and once he gets to the lead, he knows how to stay in front of him, not use his car up too much. They make a really good combination.
Crew chief, of course, for Jimmy Johnson is Chad Knaus. And, you know, we talked at on the pre-race show, you and Darrell were debating whether a veteran or a rookie or a young driver would do well here. 10 past winners of the Darlington race started today, but none have led. We've had 10 different leaders.
I think right now what you're seeing is a lot of these young guys that are really just kind of making it tough on those veterans, because a veteran likes to try to save his race car for the final 100 miles. And here at Darlington today, that's been very difficult to do. A lot of these young guys are really making it tough on them.
And tires always a story. We've had them shredded, we've had them cut, and guys that can manage their tires well and hang around have a good shot.
Exactly right, Chris. Remember, this is Darlington. She's a tire eater and a man beater.
Jimmy Johnson leading Kurt Busch, Bobby Labonte running third. Let's get thoughts on the strategy over these last 82 laps or so. Rejoin Larry, Darrell, and Mike.
The fastest car on the racetrack right now is Ryan Newman in sixth place, but two veterans on the move, Bobby Labonte in third, Robbie Gordon having a great day in fourth. But right now, Jimmy Johnson with a 0.3-second lead over Kurt Busch, who came within 3 inches of winning here last year.
It was close. But I've been watching this car behind Kurt Busch. Casey Kane in the 9, remember, sat on the pole, had that cut tire down, went a lap down. He's been just as quick as these two guys, but he's right where he needs to be. He don't need to push the envelope, because if we get a caution, he gets the pardon. He gets back on the lead lap.
And if we don't get another caution, I'll be surprised. Steve?
Well, Mike, just to follow up on Matt Kenseth and Greg Biffle, Kenseth had to come back down pit road after that tire problem. He said a bolt backed out of a spacer. And then Greg Biffle just seconds ago said, oh, gosh, we got problems. That right front that he had talked about, that vibration has come back.
Yeah, just to follow up on Matt Kenseth, they have a wheel spacer that goes between the hat that holds the rotor on and the wheel itself, and they normally will put Allen bolts to hold that all in place. It sounds like one of those backed out, and Darrell, when that happens, you can't get the wheel up there and get it tight.
Yeah, and a little bit on Greg Biffle, when he puts his foot on the brake, he's probably a left foot breaker, that rotor is warped, and it tries to knock your foot off the pedal because you get that warped vibration in the right front.
Ryan Newman continues to move to the front. He goes past Jeremy Mayfield. That is for fifth place. And last time by, quickest cars on that lap, second place Kurt Busch and Newman.
And just to update everyone that maybe just joined us, Ryan Newman led this race for quite a bit, and he actually was the leader when he came to pit road under green. He missed the commit line and almost spun coming on the pit road. NASCAR penalized him a lap. He made that lap back up. And here he is with about 75, 80 laps to go. He's trying to get back to the front.
Let me just clarify. They gave him a drive-through penalty, which under green has the effect of losing a lap, but the penalty itself was not a full race lap. Robbie Gordon, Darrell, you said he's not timid here.
No,
is he timid anywhere?
No, he isn't. He just drives hard all the time. And I watched him earlier in the race in traffic. And where other people would say, okay, I'll give you a break, when they gave him a break, Robbie was right there taking advantage of it. And that's what he's done today. He has taken advantage of everything that's come his way.
Dick Bergren.
And Gordon is having the best day ever here at Darlington. He started in 29th spot. He is now running at fourth. And here is the sequence of conversation that we have heard on his radio. First, his crew told him, you're doing great. A few laps later, Gordon came on the radio and said, I'm loose. Then a few laps after that, he said, now I'm tight in the middle. Then he lost the spot. And about two laps after that, he said, the car is coming back. So take your choice. The car is great, the car is tight, the car is loose, depending on where they are in the tire run.
Where they are in the tire run and how you hit your marks. If you miss your mark a little bit here, the car will feel one way. It'll push. Miss it a little bit, it'll be loose. So that's why you get that backs and forth thing.
Casey Kane, that nine car, he has unlapped himself under green. And, I mean, this is the good news, bad news. They've got a race car good enough that can win this race. What they need now, they need a caution where they can get caught back up. But I think they need that caution soon where they've got more time to get back to the front.
Well, here's the good news for him. He knows if they get a caution, he's going to be back in the race because he got a good car. What he also knows is he's pulling away from the guy leading the race. If I can get far enough ahead, my crew gives me a great stop that last time in, I've still got a chance to win this race.
Well, I tell you who has a chance to win this race, Ryan Newman in that 12 car. He has now caught Robbie Gordon. This will be a battle for fourth right here. Ryan Newman, I think he wants this thing to stay green, unlike Casey Kane.
He's still the fastest thing on the racetrack. He and Jeremy Mayfield last lap had the quickest laps over everybody else by about a tenth or more.
But as we watch this battle right here between Robbie Gordon, Ryan Newman, and Jeremy Mayfield, again, this is a battle for fourth. I want to talk just a little bit about strategy, and Darrell, you're going to have to work with me on this. We have about 75 laps to go. We went back racing with about 100 to go. If this thing stays green, and I'm going to bring my crew chief buddy in on this conversation as well, Jeff Hammond, we went back racing with 100 to go. I think it's going to be who will commit to pit road the earliest, as Jamie McMurray did earliest, and get the benefit of those fresh tires the quickest.
But when you do that, Larry, you know you're gambling. If that caution comes out, you lose. But if you can get in early, you can definitely get yourself in a position to take advantage of it, because one more good stop is all these guys are going to need.
And we also know one more stop to adjust on that thing. You've got to make sure you got to make the right adjustments for this racetrack condition right now. It's Kurt Busch now in the 97. He has taken the lead away from Jimmy Johnson in the 48.
Kurt Busch puts his Ford out front, trying to avenge last year's narrow defeat at the hands of Ricky Craven. NASCAR on Fox is brought to you by Radio Shack. Race into your neighborhood Radio Shack and enter the Call Your Driver sweepstakes. You could win a dream trip to the Samsung Radio Shack 500, even a new car. Enter today at Radio Shack. 226 laps complete in Darlington. Bobby Labonte has taken second place, and Ryan Newman moved to third, displacing Jimmy Johnson back to fourth. Now Jamie McMurray has just moved into sixth ahead of Robbie Gordon.
Well, they have made some great adjustments on that 18 car today, and that's the best looking car out there right now. I mean, he is just really moving through the field and up to second place. He's got a fast race car.
The 2000 winner of the Southern 500, Bobby Labonte.
But guys, I tell you, someone that don't like this long run right now, we're about 15, 20 laps away from green flag stops. Jimmy Johnson in the 48 car, he just lost a position to Jeremy Mayfield in the 19 car, and he's just about to fall into the clutches of Jamie McMurray in the 42. You see his interval right there. It continues to grow. Dick Bergwin, what has Chad Knaus said about his car?
Yeah, let's ask Chad Knaus what's going on. He just stomped the floor here. What's happening with that car, Chad?
We're just real loose off right now. I don't really know what's going on. We're falling off pretty bad. We're about a half second off where we need to be, but you know, we're gonna be okay. We got one more round of pit stops to go. It's gonna be exciting. We'll have some people short pitting here pretty quick, so keep watching. But you know, these guys have done a great job. We haven't had the best race cars all year long, so we're just gonna have to get to work if we want to beat these guys.
Thanks, Chad.
To Matt Yoakum.
Dick, Jamie McMurray just passed by Jimmy Johnson, taking over that fifth position as a 21 car. Ricky Rudd has a tire going down. He tries to get down to the apron going into turn one. He makes it down safely. Caution's out. Exactly. The nine guys are jumping up and down.
Okay, Rhodes, we'll put tires on it. Beat that right front.
You see the nine crew right here, Casey Kane's crew. He will be back into this race now. We have 17 cars on the lead lap, and I think Ward Burton in the zero car will get the pardon. The caution is out.
I look at Rudd's fender and tire as the seventh caution flag of the day waves.
And, you know, Ward's going to get the free pass. He and Kenny Schrader have been racing away there, trying to stay on be the first car lap down to get it back. And Ward just passed Kenny.
They had a race of their own going on.
He had just got around him.
Ward just won a lap down about two laps ago, and so for the third time today, Schrader is denied the free pass by the timing of the caution flag. NASCAR Nextel Cup Racing on Fox is brought to you by Enterprise Rent-A-Car. We'll pick you up. Cialis is here. Ask your doctor if a free sample of Cialis is right for you. Mach 3 Turbo Champion, the only razor used by the Gillette Young Guns. And Yamaha, makers of fine motorcycles and ATVs. Nobody's more in tune with motorsports than Yamaha.
Back at Darlington, crucial pit stops on lap 233. Ryan Newman and Bobby Labonte drag race out of the pit stalls. Matt.
Leader, Kurt Busch down and away, a track bar adjustment. It's going to be a close battle up here, Ron. It's going to be very close. A nine car also in. No adjustments for Casey Kane. The 97 was just a tick on the free side. They tried to tighten him up.
I tell you, that battle on pit road, it has been unbelievable all day long. But just remember, Casey Kane, who started this race on the pole, he will be back on the lead lap as we have about 18 cars on the lead lap.
One of those will not be Rusty Wallace. Wallace had just made a green flag pit stop, and so he gets trapped by the timing of the caution flag.
I mean, it's got to the point where about all of these pit crews on pit road, they're so equal right now. It almost comes down to who don't make a mistake. Darrell, you talked about that earlier today.
Yeah, one of the things I think is really putting the pressure on the guys at the turn one end is Jimmy Johnson down here on the turn four end. He is getting in, and he's coming down that pit lane, and they know he's coming, and they got to hustle if they're going to beat him.
He's finished with his pit stop more so before all these guys are even started theirs.
Lap down cars pitting now, including Dale Jarrett, who had lost about seven more green flag laps with a long stop on pit road. Look at that log jam getting off pit road once again. How close was it?
It's about how much he lost the race by a year ago.
I know, about as close as that finish.
Tell you, big tip of the hat though, once again, we've talked about them all day long because they've been coming as this race has progressed, is that Chris Andrews led crew of Robbie Gordon in the 31 car.
Matt?
Okay,
Tommy Baldwin talking to his crew guys on their stop. Casey had a tough entry, had to back up slightly. Then Jim Pullman and Joe Krusiak were working on that left front fender. Tommy's calling Casey back in. They're going to try to work on that left front corner of the valance, but they're trying to smooth out the damage that was done to that left front fender. To Dick Berggren.
Jimmy Johnson called into his crew before that pit stop and said the car had fallen off a cliff, that the right rear fell as if it just had gone away. The pit stop, 13.70, two adjustments on the car.
Seventh caution of the day at Darlington, 234 laps complete. This may have been the final stop of the day. NASCAR Nextel Cup Racing on Fox is brought to you by Sunoco, the new official fuel of NASCAR. Good enough for NASCAR, good enough for your car. Let's get out of Steve Burns for today's Craftsman adjustment.
Hey, Mike, in the garage area this morning, a lot of crew chiefs talking about making their cars adjustable. This is one of the key ways they can do it here at Darlington. This is a spring rubber. It fits into the spring like this. This little handy tie will help them pull it out on a pit stop. Here's another one. They call this a half a rubber. They'll also do it in a quarter rubber. They can also insert these during the race, but that takes a long time. If they're going to adjust, they'd rather pull it out.
Thanks, Steve. Michael Waltrip has taken his Napa Chevy to the garage area. He hit the wall on lap 9. They made repairs, got him back out, and now he's done. How's this race going to play out? We listened in on Kurt Busch, and he sees it much like we do.
How many laps was that long run halfway through the race?
That was 61.
Set 4, you could go either way here. Gear us up for that long finish, or just give me tires and we'll race them and expect another yellow. We got to make an adjustment if we're going to be good for 62 laps.
And Darrell, I almost believe you have to go ahead and make that adjustment, thinking that this race may go green the rest of the way. If it don't, you can undo that adjustment for a short run at the end.
Yeah, there's going to be another caution. There might even be two more cautions.
But
there's
going to
definitely be one more. And this is the worst time of the race. This is when you have to hold your breath right here because, you know, running out of time. The old hourglass is just about empty. So it puts a lot of pressure on guys.
The old lady in black is standing tall right now.
Oh, yeah. She's just laughing all over. She's going to laugh herself to death.
18 lead lap cars on the outside lane for this restart. Here we go.
55 laps to go.
Kurt Busch leads Bobby Labonte, Robbie Gordon, Mark Martin, and Jimmy Johnson to turn one.
Rusty Wallace in the two car. Remember, he had made that green flag stop right before that caution. He's actually three laps down right now.
Yeah, he was a lap down when he came to pit road. Boy, Casey came back in there, guys. He got Matt Kenseth and Brendan Gaughan. They got side by side and caused Casey to have to really check up.
Nice day today for Derek Cope. Lap down, had a top 10 qualifying effort here from the quarter window of his Arnold Motor Sports number 50, showing you just how close they get to that barrier.
Side low, inside low.
Yeah, that's in the middle of the corner where he was at.
Yeah, there, still there.
He was just working with us with that shot. They pushed him right up against it. It's really close down here in 3 and 4.
You'd have to really play him with that throttle all the way off the corner on the straightaway. At the end of the straightaway, this is well over 180 miles per hour against that wall.
Well, I tell you, Bobby Labonte is coming off of turn two over there.
Jamie McMurray drops to the bottom. Moving on the lap car, Brian Vickers, and we've got a fight for the lead brewing.
Yes, we do. And Bobby Labonte, as you said, Darrell, Michael Fatback McSwain, that whole group, they've just been making the right adjustments all day long on that race car.
Yeah, he's really good over here off turn two. He just really gets off of there much better than the 97 does.
But is he measuring him now? He was right to Bush's back bumper. Now he's dropped back a couple of car lengths. Steve.
Mike, hard to believe, but Bobby Labonte has not led a lap in 2004. On lap 233, when they stopped, they made small air pressure adjustments because the 18 car was tight. Half a pound in the left rear, half pound out of the right front, half pound out of the
Guys, one thing I'm noticing down here, fastest lap of the race has just been run by your leader and the guy in second place. And one other thing I want to ask DW, hey, buddy, when do you stop racing the racetrack and start racing the competition?
Well, that's what I said, Jeff, on this restart. Now's the taking it easy and racing the track is over with. You got to figure out how you're going to win this race now. But you don't want to take yourself out like we saw Jeff Gordon and this couple of guys do here in the past. You got to really race hard, but you got to be careful.
But guys, you know the biggest thing Bobby Labonte in 18 car understands about this racetrack, you have to be there at the end. He's been running at the end of 17 consecutive races here at Darlington.
And Robbie Gordon in third right now, trying to hold off Jimmy Johnson, who's off his left rear quarter panel. There's Johnson to the inside. Whoa, Gordon almost got a piece of it. Elliott Sadler just went past Mark Martin, fifth place.
They've said a lot about Elliott today. He was the other one I was thinking of. Jeff Gordon and he were racing here last year, I think it was. They both hit the wall off of turn two, racing each other.
Yeah, Elliott Sadler, he faded a little bit in the middle of the race, but Todd Parrott and that group, they've been getting it better now here in the later stages. And you can see right there over in turn three and four how much that corner's getting shaded now. The racetrack is really cooling down there.
Sadler has now come back to fifth, Matt.
And a great day also by the pit crew that has been servicing Elliott Sadler. They picked up five spots on his last stop, and they've been picking up a spot or two every stop today. An outstanding afternoon. Elliott on the last stop, Todd Parrott tried to adjust that car with a track bar adjustment to go up. He was just too tight in the center of the corner, and he also shoveled the air pressure, just trying to help Elliott out a little bit here at Darlington, currently in the fifth position.
But DW, as hard as the 31 and the 48, and now the 38, especially Robbie Gordon in the 31, as hard as they're running their race car, right now, Kurt Busch and the 18 are content up there, kind of running single file. They're, not only is Robbie Gordon using his race car up, I mean, he's doing what he needs to do, but he's using it up, but that group's getting away.
Yeah, well, not a whole lot he can do about that because those two cars are pretty fast.
Yes, they are. You know,
they're just kind of driving away from everybody. He's just trying to keep Jimmy Johnson behind him right now. He's had a good car all day, and it's been good on long runs. So, you know, maybe he'll ease on the way here. That's what he's thinking.
I think I've got the answer to my own question. Bobby Labonte caught Kurt Busch, got right up to his back bumper, then settled in two or three car lengths back. Now he's back to his back bumper again. Patience.
Yeah, he's just waiting for Kurt. You know, don't beat yourself. Don't forget that. Don't beat yourself. Put the pressure on the guy in the lead and make him beat himself. Bobby Labonte is a patient race car driver.
And that's one reason he's been running at the end of 17 consecutive races here. But Dick Bergman, what's going on with Robbie Gordon in that 31?
You mean besides trying to hold off Jimmy Johnson that's all over his back bumper? Well, a couple of laps ago, Robbie Gordon called on the radio and said that the car is a little bit free. Richard Childress, the team owner, got on the radio and said, take care of your stuff. You've got a top five, top 10 car there. Hit your marks. That's the game plan. Hit your marks. Keep that 48 behind him.
Take it to the bank.
Yeah. What Richard Childress is telling him is Bobby Labonte in 18 is really putting pressure on Kurt Busch right now is, look, we have had a terrible season. We've had two DNFs. A good top five finish here will not be bad.
In fact, it's been 18 races since Robbie Gordon had a top 10 finish. So this is a great turnaround for them.
And I would probably say that was that win at Watkins Glen more than likely. But just look at our track temperature right now. Remember, turns three and four right here, it was 111 degrees, and back there at one and two, it was about 80 something degrees. So three and four, remember, it's the one getting the shade, Jeff Hammond. It's really cooling down.
Really is there as far as that's concerned, Larry. But Darrell, the one thing I want to know from your vantage point, these shadows, when you go up into those corners now and the wall turning black, is it difficult for the driver to keep the car off the wall now?
Jeff, I tell you, down here in three and four where the track is really, really shaded, when you come into that area where they are right now, those lead cars, it's very difficult to see that outside retaining wall. And that's where Kurt Busch is so ever so close. I just keep waiting for something to happen down there. And here comes the 42 car on pit, 42 car of Jamie McMurray on pit road with tire smoke.
Yeah, this is not scheduled. Matt, what's the problem?
Mike, about eight laps ago, he came on the radio and said, I've got a vibration. Two laps later, he says, the vibration is only in the corners, but it's also making my car tight. And he says, I think I may have a loose wheel. So they called him down pit road. Jamie made the call, slides to a stop, almost slides through his pit. As they go to work on the left right side of the car, they're talking about possibly making an adjustment. Now look how close the car is. They may have a little bit of trouble. Yep, see the jack handle hits the wall. It's going to take a number of bumps to get that car out. He's too close to the wall, sliding into his pit. A slow stop for Jamie Murray. Does a John Force out. Loses a lot of time here on pit road.
Yeah, he was pitted toward the inside of the pit box as if expecting only the right side tires might be changed. That's where he ended up.
Yeah, that's sliding's what did that. It got him slid in too close to the wall.
Ricky Rudd back in the race after a lot of damage to his Motorcraft Ford. And here is the pass for third place.
Jimmy Johnson in the 48. Remember, he'd been working Robbie Gordon in the 31 about the last 15 laps. Robbie Gordon complained about his car being loose. Jimmy Johnson in the 48 finally capitalized.
And now Elliott Sadler moves on Robbie Gordon.
And I tell you who else is moving on Robbie Gordon. Mark Martin in that sixth car just keeps getting stronger as the day goes on.
You see what I'm seeing? All of the old age and treachery, all of these older experienced drivers moving toward the front as this race winds down.
They always, the cream rises to the top, as they say.
And again, Bobby Labonte had a run on Kurt Busch. Backed out to save his stuff until when?
Yeah, he's just kind of annoying him right now, distracting him.
Just update you, Jamie McMurray in the 42 car. He is about a lap and three quarter down right now, but he does have those four fresh tires. Matt.
Larry, Matt, four fresh tires. Great diagnosis by Jamie. He did indeed, looking at the wheel, had a loose wheel.
Pretty much with 38 laps to go, that's probably going to take him out of the equation of at least contending for the win.
Larry, explain, when you take that wheel off, how do you tell if it was loose?
You'll look at the lug hose where the lug studs go through, and they'll be egg-shaped or oblong. That's the giveaway. But you have to change four because he can't tell. It's vibrating so bad, he cannot tell which one possibly might be loose.
Ryan Newman was the quickest car on the racetrack. He was coming to the front, but now he's settled back in eighth place as the lead. Whoa, about to change hands. Bobby Labonte made his move. Kurt Busch came down a little bit. They're still at it.
Bobby's so good off the two-over. Now, Kurt's going to get him back right here. He's good in three and four. Where he got beat last year here was he wasn't very good in three and four. This year, he's good in three and four. He's suffering a little bit off the two over there. Bobby Labonte is good off the two.
Yeah, Kurt last year could not put the throttle down coming off turn four. He got that wheel spin. That's how Ricky Craven got up beside him.
He's a little loose off of turn two over there, which you will be if you're going to be good down on this end of the three and four end of the racetrack.
Right there, that's where Bobby Labonte gets a run on him.
Yeah, he gets a run on him there. Kurt's loose, but that helps him in the shaded and down here in the shaded end of the racetrack.
Thing is getting a bit serious for the lead here. As we're about to ask Steve Burns what has happened to Ryan Newman.
Hey, Mike, he said he has gotten tight, and to make matters worse, he needs clean air. He's behind lap race cars, and he wants them out of the way.
Yeah, right now he's about almost 10 seconds behind our leader, Kurt Busch, right now. I'm not sure with 35 laps to go, anybody's going to get out of anyone's way.
Kurt Busch, Bobby Labonte, Jimmy Johnson, Robbie Gordon, Elliott Sadler, the front five, and the Carolina Dodge Dealers 400 on Fox. Bobby Labonte stalked Kurt Busch for 20 laps after the restart. Made the move at turn number two. Ooh.
Yeah, he's letting him know that I'm still here, but you're not going to be there very long, my friend, because he's going to drive away from you.
How about this crew reaction right here? They like what they see with about 30, 35 laps to go.
Two other drivers moving up, Jeremy Mayfield and Tony Stewart. Stewart's come up to 10th. Mayfield is now just outside the top five at sixth place and closing fast on Elliott Sadler. Quaker State aerial coverage. There's Highway 151, the left of your screen, and the back straightaway here in Darlington, South Carolina. And turns one and two, the big end of the racetrack, if you will. Bobby Labonte. Race leader now by 1.4 seconds. Remember Kurt Busch's audio when he said, either give me four tires for a short run or adjustments for a long run. Matt, what did they do?
They made some adjustments on that race car, track bar adjustments. Jimmy, what is Kurt saying about your car now?
Well, we've been fighting loose on accelerator all day, and we just can't get it. If we do get it, then we end tell you, this Sharpie bunch here, they gave some awesome stops. Kurt's doing a hell of a job, so we'll go from there.
And with a slight track bar adjustment to try to help that 97 car, hasn't won since last fall at Bristol.
But he's been pretty solid this year. Comes in here sixth in the points, so regardless, it will be a good points day for Kurt Busch in the 97 group.
Speaking of points, our point leaders have had a tough day. Matt Kenseth had a tire go down and a spin in turn number two. And Dale Earnhardt Jr. is now back there. He just lost 12th spot to Casey Kane. He's riding in 13th, while Kenseth, after a couple of stops, finds himself four laps down in 31st place.
He's just trying to find the end of this race, is all Matt Kenseth in the 17 car. But Dale Earnhardt Jr. had worked his way in the A car into the top 10, but now he's fading again in the late stages of this run.
Yeah, and it's very uncharacteristic of the 17 car. They've dug themselves into holes several times, but they've always been able to come out of them. Today it's not going to happen for them.
Greg Biffle's had an up and down day. He's just in front of Casey Kane, our 23-year-old pole sitter, only the fourth rookie to ever start on the pole at Darlington, and he's had a day in and out of the pits, had a cut tire, finds himself 12.
Yeah, he had a heck of a time over there off turn two one time. A couple cars got together in front of him, and he almost had to stop, and he lost a ton of time.
And he is the only car that unlapped himself on the racetrack on the green. He didn't do it by a free pass.
You know, if there's a driver who hasn't had an up and down day, I can't find him on this rundown.
Tell you what, that 19 car, though, we're riding with him right now, Jeremy Mayfield, he's up to fifth position, just went by Elliott Sadler. We're looking at Elliott right now, that's back in sixth in the 38 car. Jeremy's car is one of those cars that likes a long run. Ryan Newman right behind him in the 12 car, we talked about him a while ago. It's like the racetrack has somewhat went away from their adjustments.
Bobby Labonte is the first driver to lead this race who is a past Darlington winner. He's the 11th different driver to lead today. That ties the record for the spring race here. Ryan Newman makes the pass on Elliott Sadler. That puts Newman up to sixth.
This old car's been pretty good over the long haul. I think the long run, which is not characteristic of him. He's usually good for one or two laps, but today's been good on the long run.
And Newman's done a good job of overcoming that drive-through penalty. Yanks at Red Sox, presented by Taco Bell. Think outside the bun. Talk about rivalries. April 16th is that round one.
Mark Martin, that sixth car, his car likes long runs as well. Looks like Elliott Sadler in the 38 is fading here in this run because Elliott has lost two or three positions in about the last five or six laps.
Yeah, this is playing right into Mark's setup because he is another one of those guys that have been really, really steady. Not terribly fast, but real consistent.
Twenty laps to go in Darlington County at NASCAR's most storied super speedway. Dick Rathman, the first spring race winner in 1952. A driver who got the free pass and made the most of it today is Kevin Harvick. Two caution flags ago, he got the go around after dropping a lap, but he has rebounded to the ninth place.
His car was not good at all when this race started. In fact, they went a lap down fairly early. It was through that cycle of green flag stops. Ryan Newman goes by. We have caution on the racetrack.
Kyle Petty, a lot of smoke from under the hood of his brawny Dodge. Remember, they changed the rear end in that car earlier in the race, got Kyle back out on track even though he's 30 laps down, and he will bring out the eighth caution of the day.
There is no question, there's 18 laps to go. Everybody will come to pit road for four tires. Darrell, the race off pit road could be the race.
And the guy down here in the first pit on the turn four in, the 48 car, has been coming out of there pretty strong every pit stop. This could make a huge difference. Now we got ourselves a shootout.
Engine let go right in the middle of the corner down there in turn three and four on Kyle's car.
Hey, Hammond, how about that 48 pit? What do you think? Is it going to pay off for him, buddy?
I think it's going to be real close, Darrell, but right now it's going to really depend on these crews. And Bobby Labonte's guys, I believe, are really pretty pumped about it, and it could be real interesting. That camera down at the end of pit road better be locked and loaded.
Labonte will have a good spot because the pit in front of him is Dale Jarrett, who cannot pit with the lead lap cars. So that means Labonte will get a good launch out of his pit.
Yeah, we have Bobby Labonte that's pitting about halfway down pit road. Kurt Busch pitting all the way at the exit of pit road. And as we've documented on several pit stops, Jimmy Johnson in the 48 pitting right there. They're at totally three different locations on pit road.
Worried about those pressures overall being too high, or is that still safe? I don't know any better.
You're going to be fine for this run.
Let's preview pit stops, beginning with Steve.
We heard Michael McSwain tell driver Bobby Labonte, we're going to go up on air pressures all the way around. Matt.
And Jimmy Finnick talking to Kurt Busch on the radio. They're talking about a wedge adjustment at this juncture to try to see if that's what they need to put this car in victory lane. To Nick Berggren.
All day long, Jimmy Johnson has discussed the car. Crew chief Chad Knaus has made the call. This time, Jimmy Johnson is making the call. They're going to adjust tire pressures in his car to try to improve it.
And what these guys are doing, Mike and Daryl, is they're talking about bringing the pressures up just a little bit. You let them down for long runs because they gain so much pressure. But, Daryl, at this racetrack here, cars start sliding around so early, I don't know if I'd go a whole lot on those air pressures.
I would not go very much at all, Larry. I mean, the driver's so uncomfortable when the pressures are real low, but the pressures build up so quickly here, too.
Got a lot of great stuff from out of the pits today. Happy birthday to our pit producer, Pam Miller.
Happy birthday, Pam.
Pammy, happy birthday.
See, the pace car brings them around at 50 miles per hour. Pit road speed is 45 miles per hour. The pace car, pace truck runs about 5 miles an hour quicker. This could be it, boys, right here. This is where you have pumped that crew up. Five off, five on, no mistakes by anyone.
This is it. This is your best chance to win right here. Dick Berggren.
Well, Chad Knaus has got his crew all pumped up and ready to go, and here comes Jimmy Johnson for what will be the most important pit stop of the day. They have been flawless all day long. They need to be absolutely perfect this time around. Right side. Guys look good. Up with a jack on the left side. So far, no mistakes. Nice, smooth pit stop. There he goes.
Bobby Labonte in smoothly. Mark Armstrong and Barry Cook changing tires. They've gone up on those air pressures. Jack Mann, Jason Lee comes around, gets it fired up. Left side tires going on. Good stop for Bobby Labonte. Matt.
A nice entry by 25-year-old Kurt Busch. Wedge adjustment already completed. The guy, Scott Radel, jacks up that left side. The left side tires going on. And
it was a drag race all the way down pit road after Bobby Labonte pulled out of his pit box.
And I guess NASCAR will call that one. John Darby, the Nextel Cup director, is looking at the video now, because when Bobby Labonte came out of his pit, he came out dead even with Jimmy Johnson, and that's the way they went all the way down the pit lane. Jimmy's crew, Chad Knaus' crew, knew they had a good stop on the low Chevy. We'll see how NASCAR rules it. Here's a look at the video. Advantage, Johnson.
And you got to give a tip of the hat to Chad Knaus. He could have picked any pit selection up and down this pit road. He chose that one, and it worked.
The real loser, though, was Kurt Busch in that 97 car. He's going to come out about fifth or sixth.
Darlington finish, 15 laps to go. And back at the Hollywood Hotel, Jeff Hammond, Chris Myers. You know, you were saying when Bobby Labonte, when they were going up on the air pressure, shaking your head, said, no, I disagree with that.
You got to be real careful here, Chris, because this racetrack, I mean, it eats the tires up and wears these things so bad and it starts sliding around. If you put too much air pressure in there to try to compensate for what they build up over the long run, you're going to get yourself in trouble. So they got to be real careful. Maybe a half a pound, but not a lot more than that.
DW talking about the Chad Knaus, the pit selection, the 48 crew, Jimmy Johnson's car. It's something we've seen some wild stuff coming off of pit road, and yep. This they were in the best position at this time of the race.
Yeah, what I really kind of like am impressed about right now more than anything else is Chad Knaus, a lot like a football coach or a baseball coach, he studies tendencies at a racetrack. You have to do that to understand maybe what might happen during the course of the race, and I think he's done an excellent job of picking his pit stall out. And Larry Mack, you know good and well, this can be so important whenever you're trying to figure out what to do when it comes to qualifying, where you need to put your car for race day.
Well, I mean, we've had great racing on the racetrack all day long, but I've just been amazed and thrilled to see these races between these pit crews. As I said earlier, it's not about who's been having quick stops or not. It's almost been about pit selection and no mistakes on pit road.
We started the day with a lot of these young guns up front, Darrell, but now experience, Jimmy Johnson, and you got to like Bobby Labonte.
Yeah, Bobby Labonte's got a great car. He obviously could take the lead there when he wanted to, but now what you got to worry about is, is this set of tires going to be good? Were those little adjustments that they made going to mess this car up? Because you cannot make a mistake right here in the front of the field, or you'll get passed by everyone.
And there's the X factor right behind those two, Robbie Gordon.
Robbie Gordon, a guy who participated in the Busch race, finished seventh. Here's a guy who's going to do the double once again, the Indy 500 and the Coca-Cola 600. He's done a good job of hanging in there, taking what the track has given him most of the day.
Most of the day, Chris, and one thing I've kind of noticed about Robbie's car, over the long run, has kind of suffered. But the short run, I mean, we're going to have probably less than about 12 laps to go when we get with Green back. He could be a factor. He could be a spoiler here if those two guys in front get to beating and banging on each other, which is, you know, pretty likely to happen. Guarantee you, Jimmy Johnson's not going to give that lead up without a lot of
Let's check out the pit summary, Jeff. Has played such an important part of what's gone on today, and you see Jimmy Johnson hailing and Bobby Labonte. That's why they're currently running 1-2.
Tell you right now, those pit crews, Larry Mack keeps talking about them. It's just such a lot of fun to sit up here and watch them do their thing, stop after stop after stop. Great athletes down there on pit road, and that's what it's all about. You've got to build a rise to the occasion when it counts. So far, Jimmy Johnson's crew has done an outstanding job.
Best Darlington finish, third for Jimmy Johnson, currently the leader. Let's listen to his in-car audio.
Now, this is why we pay you the big bucks now. Let's go get this thing. Step four.
I'm going to encourage him.
One to go at the line with Bobby Labonte running second, Gordon third.
And that was Rick Hendrick, the owner of that 48 car, along with Jeff Gordon, giving him a little bit of encouragement.
Hendrick Motorsports, a lot of success over the years here at Darlington, so let's get ready for the final 13 laps. Rejoin Larry, Darrell, and Mike.
You drove for Rick Hendrick. He ever say that to you, Darrell?
He never did. That is so uncharacteristic of him to say something like that, but he's just excited. He wants Jimmy to win this race. That's just a good car owner right there.
Fans, you can play Race the Pros online video game now, only on FoxSports.com, keyword games. Jimmy Johnson, our leader. Bobby Labonte, a past Darlington champion, in second. Robbie Gordon, who has one oval track cup victory. That came at New Hampshire. Got to think orange paint's going to get on something before this is over. Ryan Newman's got a shot in the Dodge. Elliott Sadler, fifth in a Ford, as is Kurt Busch and his teammate Mark Martin. Kevin Harvick, Chevy. Mayfield's Dodge. Biffle's Ford, that's the top 10. The other lead lap cars, Earnhardt, Jeff Burton, Marlin, Ward Burton, Wimmer, Kane, the pole sitter, Tony Stewart, and Casey Mears.
And since we're not within 10 laps to go, it will be a double file restart. All those cars, beginning with Terry Labonte and the 5 car on the inside. And what you got to remember, there's 8 or 9 of those cars that are racing for position. So they're not going to be real give and take here either.
As Ken Schrader likes to say, this could get big.
Yeah, it could. And the two guys in front, the 48 car and the 18, Jimmy Johnson and Bobby Labonte, they're a couple of really gentlemen racers. From here on back, take the gloves off, boys, because something's getting ready to fly.
11 laps to go when they get the green flag.
Restart real important. I'm going to be getting that restart as close to that mark as I can. I want to get the heck out of here.
Bobby Labonte, the 18 car, the thing he wants to do is clear his brother, Terry Labonte, in that 5 car. Beat him down to turn one, which he does. Look at Bobby Labonte. He wants to take advantage of those fresh tires early over in turn two.
Can't do it.
That's where he's been really strong. He looks so hot over there that time.
Good clean restart.
10 to go this time.
They spin. Turn three. Casey Kane.
Casey Kane in the 9 car. Caution is out. Casey was running about the 14th position. He will not lose a lap, though. He will stay on the lead lap. Remember, the field is frozen right now. Darrell, this is where Chad Knaus, Michael Fatback McSwain, and by the way, Terry Labonte, I think, in the 5 car. Well, I don't know if we do it within 10 laps, so we'll have to find out about that.
Did Casey Kane have help? Let's see. Oh, the field stacks up.
Yeah, it's a chain reaction thing, and then I think Casey doesn't realize that. Yeah, see, Tony got into him right there. Tony got into him right there. Tony.
Well, Casey had to check up for Brendan Gaughan and whoever was alongside him. It's one of those domino effect deals.
That was the first contact. That was the second contact.
Well, I said there was going to be orange paint on something. I wasn't sure what from. And how about Casey Kane, Darrell? He has kept that car off the wall through a couple of wild slides today.
He really has. This has been his great adventure. He'll love his first Darlington race. He'll remember it anyway.
I was about to say Terry Labonte in the 5 car would get the pardon of the free pass. When you get to 10 to go, that's all off. There is no free pass.
You mean we're going to have to get our pulse rate all built up again?
Absolutely.
I love it. All of you folks that have been writing that the racing's been boring, keep those cards and letters, folks. Keep them at home. This is pretty neat. You can see that the grill of Tony Stewart's car where he got in the back of Casey Kane.
And remember what he's trying to do. He came in here second points. He's trying to capitalize on Matt Kenseth's troubles, who's sitting 31st back in position right now. Tony Stewart is in 16th.
How do you counsel aggressive patience now?
You don't. I mean, like I said, it's gloves off, baby. And that's exactly what happened there when Tony was trying to go by on the outside. Casey squeezed him a little bit, kind of irritated Tony the Tiger there.
A pit road is still closed, but we only anticipate that maybe someone back at the back of the field, like Scott Wimmer, Tony Stewart, Casey Mears, Casey Kane, would come to pit road and get 4 tires, because we only have 2 laps on those tires.
They're just right. Scuffed them in, they're ready to go. Biggest thing now, you got to worry about right now is getting a good restart. Don't spin the tires. Don't let anything happen to that car on the restart.
Larry, you're right on the 10 to go rule, but since the caution came out prior to the leader getting 10 laps to go, Terry Labonte's going to get
He's going to get the free pass. Okay.
Going to be a quickie yellow, which means all cars can pit the first time by. Here's Dick Berggren.
Interesting audio on Jimmy Johnson's radio. Chad Knaus just called on the radio and said, we'd like to have the win, but remember the big picture. We've got a top 10. Remember the big picture. Almost immediately after, Rick Hendrick got on the radio and said, you let that 18 car go by, we may have to repossess your airplane.
How's that for motivation?
Yeah. Now, see, that's the difference of me and Jimmy Johnson. When I drove for Rick, he said, we're going to have to take back your demo. And he wasn't talking about a demo airplane.
No, your car.
My car.
Now it's an airplane.
That's right.
There's Rick Hendrick.
Well, now, he's had an up-and-down day. His star performer, Jeff Gordon, got taken out in a crash back at lap 28. Terry Labonte is running 19th. He'll be the last car on the lead lap. Jimmy Johnson is our race leader. And his fourth car, with rookie Brian Vickers, is 24th.
And he is responsible, in my opinion, for making the sport what it is today. He realized way back in the 80s that you needed multi-car teams. And he started with that concept, and he never gave up on it until he made it work.
Again, we're quite sure of our 18 cars on the lead lap that probably the top 13, 14 right in there will stay out. But I'm sure we're going to see some at the back of the field come in. Really nothing to lose, and that's what's happening is to see Tony Stewart, the 20 car, Casey Kane in the 9 car, all these guys coming to pit road, try to make some adjustments.
I think that's Greg Biffle. It's Ward Burton, the first car in that group.
Casey Mears in the 41. Yep. Yeah, and Ward Burton in the 0.
Burton is a lead lap car, so is Mears.
And, of course, Terry Labonte, who got the lap back, he come down to pit lane, got him some tires, so might pick up another spot or two there.
And he will have to restart, though, at the tail end of the longest line since he did get the pardon.
Might be the safest place to be in some of these restarts.
Might be.
We're going to have about a 5-lap shootout here in Darlington to finish off the Carolina Dodge Dealers 400.
Shootout. That's mild.
Oh, this is what makes Darlington, Darlington. The lady in black is just, she's happy as she can be right now.
And of our 60,000 plus people right now, we don't need any seats because no one is sitting in them.
But nobody has left either.
No, sir. You don't never leave a NASCAR race early.
Well, maybe last week and the week before, but not today.
Not today.
Jeff?
You're thinking. I've been thinking, Mike, what's going to happen here at the end is really simple. Bing, bang, boom. It's exactly what it's going to be like here when they drop the green flag.
The thing that scared me the most, D.W., was Hammond was thinking down
yeah,
there.
Yeah, I know. Well, I don't mind being the bing, and I don't mind being the bang, but I don't want to be the boom.
These caution laps to a crew right now, they seem like they last eternity. And I'm sure they probably do to the drivers out there, too. It's like, come on, man, let's get this race restarted.
Well, yeah, you're sitting there thinking about all the things that are wrong with your car. Boy, if my car would just do this or if my car would just do that, I could probably win this race.
Well, now it looks like it'll be a four-lap shootout. NASCAR, again, has a somewhat new procedure. They give the field a two-to-go sign and move the free pass car around and get everyone lined up, and now they're on one to go. This is the objective, and only one car will fit here, victory lane.
Yeah, but more crews and that'll fit in there.
Yeah.
I've been in there with other crews before.
Now this will be what we call a down finger restart, which means single file lead lap cars only to the front, so there will be no lap traffic to the inside on this restart. I'm gonna keep a close watch on that orange number 31 car, Robbie Gordon, not to mention the gentleman behind him on Ryan Newman in that 12 car.
Well, that's what I say. If something should happen, just a little something happened to that 48 car on a restart, or he slips down here in the corner, Katie barred the door then, boys.
They will be there to capitalize.
They will.
Robbie Gordon looking for his first top 10 since Michigan last August, just after he had that Watkins Glen win 18 races ago. Looks like he's going to get it, but don't leave because anything can happen. There are 19 cars on the lead lap as they get one to go. So they'll come around to complete lap 289 and have a four lap fight to the finish.
And just like you heard Rick Hendrick say, hey, that's why we pay you the big bucks. I don't want to hear about missing a shift, spinning the tires. I don't want to hear any of that. Focus, get your job done.
But Darrell, even though those laps only have two laps on them, this is where you are prone. This will be the first time these guys have had a restart on tires that are not brand new. You've almost got to baby that throttle a little bit on this restart.
One other thing to remember, if something happens and the caution comes out, we're past the point where they would red flag this race. If the caution comes out, race over.
The field is frozen no matter what lap we're on. There you see 50, 55 miles per hour, the pace truck bringing them down.
And as nervous and uptight as you are when the race starts, nobody knows what this feels like right here except somebody that's been there and done that. And right now your heart is pounding out of your chest.
You've got all the opportunity and four laps to find a way to make it work.
Pace truck is off.
Johnson, Labonte, Gordon, Newman, Sadler, Busch, Martin, Harvick, Mayfield, Biffle, the top 10. Four laps to go.
Ready. Great flag.
Jimmy Johnson in the 48. He gets a pretty good restart, nice and clean.
Bobby Labonte may have laid off in a little bit because Bobby has really been good off of turn two, but Jimmy is scooting away right now. Here's where Bobby has been good in the past coming off of turn two. Johnson looks like he's up for the task.
Ryan Newman in that 12 car, he got a good run off turn two. He wants to get to Robbie Gordon in the 31 for that third position. He pulls to the inside, about 10 car lengths behind our top two.
These cars on worn tires now, though they had a chance to cool under the caution. Newman side by side with Gordon. They may trade a little paint before they get to turn one.
And with three to go, that's good news for Bobby Labonte in 18, Jimmy Johnson in 48. It'll be a two-man race here. But Ryan Newman does clear the 31, and what a run he gets off turn two.
And Bobby Labonte got a great run off, too. He's right to Johnson's bumper.
That's where he's going to make his move. If he can get him, he's going to get under him there. Well, although it looks like he's trying to look underneath, but he hadn't been that good on the outside off of turn four. Where he's going to get him is when he gets down into turn two and get alongside of him going down the back straightaway and then hopefully hang on.
Two to go.
Here he comes. He's been really good right over here. From here off the corner, He can stay in the throttle. Close, close, close. Here I come. Johnson's got the power under the hood to hold him off.
There's the two crews right here. Lap and a half to go. The 18 crew on the left, the 48 crew on the right. There's Bobby Labonte at the bottom. Jimmy Johnson so good on the high side off turn four. White flag this time.
Johnson, I think, said after that charge that Bobby Labonte put on him there a while ago, he said, if that's all you got, that ain't enough.
He may have one more shot, DW.
Jimmy went in a little bit low that time. Here comes Bobby. 18 cars. Just doesn't quite have the steam down the straightaway, but he's going to dive her in here hard, baby. Come on.
I guarantee he'll drive it in down here in turn three and four. He went to the high side, but Jimmy Johnson in the 48 well. He just needs to come nice and straight off turn four.
Jimmy Johnson, the low Chevrolet. Jimmy becomes the 41st driver to win at Darlington.
These guys are beating and banging. These are all lead lap cars. But Ryan Newman will finish third, Robbie Gordon fourth, Elliott Sadler fifth, Kurt Busch sixth, Mark Martin seventh, Harvick eighth, Mayfield ninth, and Dale Earnhardt Jr. comes back to finish 10th.
That's amazing that Jr. come back to 10th because he has had a terrible day after the start of this race.
Jeff Burton, Casey Kane, and Casey Mears each picked up a position on the last lap.
DW, remember the first time you won here, the granddaddy of them all?
I did. Chris Economaki interviewed me. Well, Darrell, how's it feel winning at the Laney and Blank?
That's very good. Very good.
I'd say we'll see some burnouts. What do you think?
They called him Hot Rod on the radio during the race. Hot Rodding began and grew up in California. So did this guy.
He definitely knows how to do a burnout.
Yeehaw! Randy Dorton's the head engine builder at Hendrick, has been for many years. He won't mind losing an engine in that fashion.
And just remember, these guys had been in the top 10 in points for almost two complete years, 70 races. They hit that wall at Rockingham, got in that wreck, but as Chris Meyer said earlier, in the last two races, they have come from 25th to 9th, and I'd say it's even going to be higher after this race in the points.
They may not get on him for blowing up his engine, but he better not back that car in the wall, I can tell you that.
And talk about tight. Look what's happened to the point standings. The top eight are all within 100 points of each other. Just like a vise that keeps tightening up.
Well, the 26 and 10 deal has put the pressure on these guys. They just got to, you can't have very many bad races and expect to be in a championship contender.
Welcome to the Nextel post-race show, brought to you by Nextel. NASCAR and Nextel, partners in speed. Steve Burns has the runner-up.
And Bobby Labonte talking to Michael McSwain. Bobby, you guys, I heard you say that car was a handful early in the race, but they got you hooked up, and then talk about the shootout at the end.
Yeah, I mean, it was a little bit of a handful early on, and the guys adjusted on it, Michael and everybody. They worked real hard to get this car a little bit better throughout the day. And, a little bit of redemption from Atlanta. We missed out a little bit at Atlanta. If I'd have known that last weekend, I wouldn't have gone to work on Sunday, guys, because it was kind of embarrassing. But anyway, the guys did a good job. I mean, pit stops were good. We got beat out a little bit there at the end. But, on a short run, we probably weren't quite as good. Obviously, the long run, we were before that caution came out when Kyle blew his motor. And, crushed the 97 car there at that point in time, just trying to make it to the end. But caution flag got us. And, it still is a great run for us. A good top five, and we needed that. And I'd just like to thank everybody on this Interstate Battery, Chevrolet, Will Buchern, Coca-Cola, MB&A, all our sponsors. And it was a good day.
Thanks, Bobby. Let's go to Dick.
With Ryan Newman, we're going to jump in here a little bit. From a lap down, did you think that was the end of the day for you?
No, when you're leading and you go a lap down because the driver makes a mistake going on pit road, I knew we had a car that was capable of running in the top five for sure. And Bat and the guys did a great job. Awesome pit stop there in the last one and got us a spot. And then we got one more on the racetrack.
Well done. Finishing third today.
Jimmy Johnson with today's victory gains 3 in the Nextel Cup point standings. Chad Knaus congratulating him in victory lane.
A victory right there, boys.
Hey, that's the
with a hug by his dad for the third time in past four Darlington races. A Hendrick car is in victory lane, and you kept saying, I can't believe I've won Darlington. How special is this place?
Unbelievable. I can tell you right now, Gatorade hurts in the eyes. I can tell you that much. Nice to be here and win. Thanks, boss.
By the way, you're not going to repo the plane now.
Not going to repo the plane this week. You just keep it another week.
This is unbelievable. This has been a huge goal of mine to try to win at Darlington, and we've always had a great car and been very close. And then to do it today with the teamwork that we had. We were a great car in the short run. The pit stops what made the difference, got us the lead, got us the win. And I had to outdo my little brother. He had his first late model race last night, finished second, so had no choice but to win. So I'm happy with that. And say hello to my fiance. She's up in New York watching. I know she's flipping out right now.
And to win Darlington's one thing, but to win it in such dramatic fashion, what were you thinking when Labonte tried his move late?
Bobby was a better car. I knew I had better air being in the lead, and I just needed to protect it and block it. And I knew he was coming, but luckily it was a short run, and we were able to bring the slowest Monte Carlo to victory lane. So awesome day. I can't believe this. This is the highlight of my career so far.
A hug by his dad. His little brother got a second last night. Jimmy Johnson scores his first Darlington win.
Chevy congratulates Jimmy and the number 48 Monte Carlo team on today's big win. No car has dominated cup racing like defending manufacturer's champ Chevrolet. Here is the Chevy winning moment. And last pit stop for Jimmy Johnson and crew. Beating Bobby Labonte to the line on pit road by a foot and holding him off to the finish. Wow, what a day. We'll be back to Darlington, South Carolina. Chris and Jeff will recap when we come back.
Fox welcomes you back to Darlington. 28-year-old Jimmy Johnson from El Cajon with the victory. He talked about his girlfriend, actually his fiancée, Chandra, who is watching this race. They're engaged. They plan to be married in December, but he was thinking about other things when he crossed the finish line here.
You are the man. I am so proud of you. I am so proud of you.
No way! Oh! Darlington, can you believe this? Darlington!
Maybe it wasn't quite as close as last year, Darrell, but it sure was just as exciting.
You know what? You put the world's greatest drivers on one of our toughest racetracks, and you get a show like we had today. How much more exciting can it get?
And then you throw minds like Chad Knaus, Jimmy Johnson's crew chief, in his pit selection that he made yesterday and the great pit stops those guys had. But if you think we're on our feet the last 10 laps of this race, wait till the fastest half mile next week, 500 laps.
Wow. That's all I can say. Chris Myers. Wow.
Well, have you ever? I think we have. You saw Rick Hendrick down there with Jimmy Johnson. 10th Darlington win for Hendrick Motorsports. Hendrick, who hugged Jimmy Johnson in victory lane. And Jimmy has jumped all the way up to 6th in points, coming from 25th. Matt Kenseth, tough day for him. This is through 5 of the 36 races in the chase for the Nextel Cup Championship. You see Dale Earnhardt Jr. second, Tony Stewart third, Casey Kane the rookie, they're 5th, and we opened the day talking about the rookie on the pole, and also for the first time this year, the winner of the race was not Kenseth or Dale Earnhardt Jr.
Yeah, we finally kind of broke that little string right there going as far as that's concerned, Chris, but I mean, a great win right there by Jimmy Johnson, but I just want to say one thing. Chad Knaus did his homework this weekend.
Chevy takes a 3 out of the top 4, and there is the clever crew chief from pit selection to pit stops to working the crew, talking with the crew and owner Rick Hendrick. What do you think we could expect next week as we head to Bristol? That's always a fun ride because today's race had the most leaders we've had this year, 12, and also the most cautions, 9.
I'm going to make you mad. There's some more bing, bang, boom when we get ready to go to Bristol. Yeah. They're going to be slamming and bamming when we get up there in Bristol.
Listen to you, Big. You sound like you've been watching too much Sopranos. And the next weekend, NASCAR returns as the seat shifts to Bristol for another full weekend. Friday, the Busch Series qualifying, followed by Bud Pole qualifying. And then Saturday, Nextel Cup practice. That's on FX. And the Busch Series race presented by Taco Bell. That's on Fox. And next Sunday, start your day with NASCAR this morning on Fox Sports Net. John Roberts and the crew. And then Nextel Cup Racing presented by Quaker State on Fox. Kurt Busch looking to defend his title with the other drivers on hand. In fact, he's dominated 3 out of the last 4 times. Kurt Busch has had success in Bristol. Success today belongs to Jimmy Johnson and the Hendrick Motorsports. It was a tough day for Matt Kenseth, Dale Earnhardt Jr., Ryan Newman, the debatable black flag, but he battled his way back up to finish third. Jeff Gordon, six-time winner here, out of the race early, but four laps to go, the dash and the finish. Jimmy Johnson held off Bobby Labonte to win. Thanks for being with us. We'll see you next weekend from Bristol here at America's Gathering Place each weekend for NASCAR. Thanks for being a part of NASCAR on Fox. Enjoy your week.